Welcome to the Department of Toxic Substances Control workshop on other chemicals of interest in tires. My name is Jessica Anderson, and I am the public participation specialist with the Department of Toxic Substances Control, which we will refer to as DTSC throughout this session. I want to thank you for taking the time to join us today, especially during this challenging time. We sincerely wish you and your families are well and keeping safe. And this workshop is scheduled from 1:30 to 4:30 with a short break at 3:15. The purpose of today's webinar is to present information on DTSC's preliminary research on other chemicals of interest in tires and to hear your feedback. Dr. Alicia Taylor and I will be facilitating today's workshop. Slide two, please. You are in a view and listen only role. Today, we will be taking questions through the Q&A feature. So please click on the Q&A button at the toolbar at the bottom of your screen to send your questions or comments. You may send as many as you'd like throughout the webinar, and we will respond to in the Q&A session at each of the presentations completion. You may also send as many questions as you want, but we do request that you send one at a time so we're able to respond to them adequately. We will do our best to respond in the order that they are received, and any remaining questions will be answered at the Q&A at the end of the workshop. Please note that we will not be taking questions by the chat function, and for those joining by phone, press *9 to raise your hand and let us know you have a question. You will be called on and prompted to unmute yourself. We encourage you to send your questions or comments to Safer Consumer Products at dtsc.ca.gov, and we will do our best to respond during the Q&A session as well. Lastly, please know that we're hosting this webinar from different locations, so we request that you bear with us if there's any lag time or if there's any technical issues. We sincerely appreciate your patience, understanding, and cooperation in making this a successful meeting. Slide three, please. The agenda for today is broken down in two parts with a short Q&A presentation following each Q&A after each presentation, followed by a public comment period, and we'll use any remaining time we have left for additional Q&A and discussion. Part one will consist of general intro and opening remarks, as well as DTSC's presentation from Dr. Taylor, followed by presentations from the United States Tire Manufacturers Association, Dr. Andy Booth of Syntef Ocean, and Dr. Kelly Peter of the National Institute of Standards and Technology. We'll have a short 10-minute break at 3:15 and resume part two with presentations from Dr. Leah Chebwe of the University of Toronto, Cassandra Johannesson of Trent University, and Rebecca Sutton of the San Francisco Estuaries Institute. We'll complete that with the public comment period and remaining Q&A, and then followed by closing comments. I will now invite I'll now invite Andre Algazi, a Chief of Chemical and Product Evaluation Unit within DTSC Safer Consumer Products, to give us some opening remarks, followed by Dr. Alicia Taylor, environmental scientist, to begin our presentation. Andre?
Thank you, Jessica, and welcome back, everybody. I know many of you are at this morning's workshop on zinc and tires. And I spoke briefly at the end of that event. I lead what we call our chemical and product evaluation team, which investigates products in the priority product work plan that we issue each 3 years to identify potential priority products. We have a full agenda of speakers today that represent a wide range of perspectives on chemicals and tires, and I think we'll all find it informative and enlightening. So I just want to thank you all for your attendance this afternoon, for engaging with us on the important issues around exposure to chemicals and tires and potential adverse impacts that could result from exposure to those chemicals. This morning, our public workshop on zinc, which is used in vulcanizing rubber that's used in tires, was focused on a specific product chemical combination, zinc and tires. Tomorrow, we'll have another similar sort of topic, 6-PPD, which is an anti-ozonant that's also added to tires. So this afternoon's topic is a little bit different, however. We've researched both zinc and 6-PPD in more depth, and we intend to develop regulations to add tires that contain these two chemicals to our priority products list under our regulatory framework. This afternoon, we're going to be discussing some other chemicals that are found in tires that we've identified and done some preliminary screening research on. Most of these chemicals are on our candidate chemicals list, and we've summarized our preliminary research very briefly in a background document that's posted on our CalSafer web portal. Dr. Alicia Taylor of our staff will be summarizing our preliminary findings on these chemicals, and also she'll be posing some questions that we're hoping that you, our stakeholders, including those of you here today at the workshop, can help answer. For those of you who aren't familiar with our regulatory framework, Alicia will also be giving some brief background on our process to provide a little bit of context for today's discussions. We have a public comment period open until Friday, September 17th. We'll talk more about that later. We're hoping that you will take advantage of the opportunity to submit written comments that will help us decide on next steps for the chemicals that we're going to be talking about today. So thanks again for attending. And without further ado, I'd like to turn it over to Dr. Alicia Taylor.
Thank you for the introduction, Andre. Welcome, everyone. We're excited to have you all in attendance today. And thank you for being here for our workshop on other chemicals of interest in tires. Slide 5, please. I'd first like to briefly mention the 4-step regulatory process used by the Safer Consumer Products Program to reduce potentially harmful chemicals in products. First, chemicals on the candidate chemical list are those that have been previously identified by authoritative bodies. There's enough evidence for these chemicals to be listed as a concern. For chemicals that are not on the candidate chemical list, DTSC may conduct preliminary research to determine if a chemical should be added to the candidate chemical list through rulemaking. For example, the chemicals discussed today that are currently not on DTSC's candidate chemical list, and based on our research findings, could be added to the list at a later date with rulemaking. Once these chemicals have been identified, step two is when a product chemical combination is selected for further research. And this is the step in which rulemaking may be initiated. In step three, manufacturers may perform an alternatives analysis to identify a safer alternative that can be used in the product chemical combination. In step four, further regulatory actions may be taken by DTSC. I will not go through each step in more detail, and you can find more information on our regulatory process on our website. The blue arrow indicates where we are in the process for these other chemicals. I will discuss step two in a little bit more detail on the next slide. Slide 6, please. So here you can see step two broken down into its individual components. We are currently engaged in the first step, which is a screening step for the other chemicals found in tires. This step includes today's workshop, which is the public engagement component. And you can see the orange circle on the slide that indicates where we are in the process. I'd like to make it very clear that at this time, we are not yet proposing to add tires containing any of these chemicals as a priority product. Again, we're in a very initial screening step. Slide 7, please. Now, I've covered most of this information on the last two slides, and again, I'd like to reiterate that we are not yet proposing to add tires containing any of these chemicals that will be discussed today as a priority product. Again, we're in an initial screening step, and so far, this screening has been non-exhaustive. So today, we are soliciting information on other tires and chemicals that we can screen. Our goal is to learn more about these 6 chemicals that will be discussed today, as well as any other chemicals that may be in tires. This public workshop is an important step in obtaining more information. And overall, these six chemicals that will be discussed today were selected due to concerns regarding their effects in the aquatic environment. Now, today we have six experts lined up to speak to you about these chemicals. But before we hear from our speakers, I will give an overview on these six chemicals, their uses in tires, and their effects in the environment. Slide 8, please. Our first chemical is benzothiazole. But first, I'd like to orient everyone on the content that you'll be seeing on these next few slides. For each of the slides that I will show, you'll find the chemical structure on the right-hand side of the slide. And in addition, if the chemical is on DTSC's candidate chemical list, you will also see the orange CC symbol. It's also in the upper right-hand corner. I'd like to go ahead and point out that four of the six chemicals I'll discuss today are on DTSC's candidate chemical list. But back to benzothiazoles. Benzothiazoles are a class of chemicals, and this is based on a variety of functional side groups that can be added to the molecule. They are used as an accelerant in tire manufacturing. In the environment, benzothiazoles have been found in stormwater, dust, and sediment. Only one benzothiazole, 2-mercaptobenzothiazole, is currently on DTSC's candidate chemical list, and it is a known carcinogen. One question that we have about benzothiazoles is intentional versus unintentional uses of these chemicals in the final tire product. We'd like to solicit more information on their general use and function in tires. Now, I'd also like to point out that during this presentation, you will see a link shared in the chat in the Zoom. The link will be for the published document on these six other chemicals, and this document is found on DTSC's website. So after the presentation, you can find more information on these chemicals using this link. Slide 9, please. Next, we have chlorinated paraffins, which are also a class of chemicals based on the variation in chain length. Again, I'd like to point out that the chemical structure and the candidate chemical listing are shown in the upper right-hand corner. These chemicals have many uses, but they have been found in rubber additives. When rubber tires are reused as fill material in playgrounds, this material is called crumb rubber. Chlorinated paraffins have been found to leach from crumb rubber. In the environment, chlorinated paraffins have been found everywhere and are also found in aquatic organisms' tissues. Hazard traits include bioaccumulation, persistence, and wildlife impairment. Slide 10, please. Our third chemical is hexamethoxymethylmelamine, or HMMM. This chemical is a crosslinker that is used during resin formation, and while it has many uses, it is found in tires. In the environment, HMMM has been found in runoff, rivers, and it has been identified in tire leachate. HMMM is not on DTSC's candidate chemical list, and information about its potential hazard traits is extremely limited. At this time, we have identified toxic effects in Daphnia. Slide 11, please. Octophenyl ethoxylates and octophenol are a class of chemicals that are commonly used as surfactants. Their use as a surfactant is likely the reason that these chemicals are found extensively in the environment. However, another use is in rubber products. OP and OPEs are listed on DTSC's candidate chemical list. Hazard traits include endocrine toxicity, bioaccumulation, persistence, and wildlife impairment. One potential concern is that when OPEs enter the environment, they can then degrade into the more toxic OP form. While these chemicals are used in rubber manufacturing, it is unclear if their presence in tires after manufacturing is intentional or unintentional, or if these chemicals have a continued use in the finalized tires. We would like to solicit more information on this question. Slide 12, please. Next, we have 1,3-diphenylguanidine. 1,3-diphenylguanidine is an accelerant in rubber and tire manufacturing. In the environment, DPG has been found in runoff and water. While this chemical is not on DTSC's candidate chemical list, potential hazard traits include persistence, mobility, and aquatic toxicity. In one study in California roadway runoff, DPG was in the top 10 most abundant compounds detected. Slide 13, please. This is our sixth and final chemical we'll discuss today. As a class, there are over 100 polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, and this is due to the possible combinations of fused rings. PAHs have been well studied and are found everywhere in the environment. However, less information is available on their use in tires. In tires, PAHs appear to improve rubber properties, and they are also found in carbon black, which is used as a filler in tires. However, more information on their exact purpose and function in tires is needed by DTSC. PAHs are on DTSC's candidate chemical list, and PAHs have numerous hazard traits. PAHs are considered a carcinogen, mutagen, and reproductive toxicant. In addition, they are persistent, bioaccumulative, and toxic. And depending on the particular PAH, they may also be very persistent and/or very bioaccumulative. Slide 14, please. This concludes the overview of the six chemicals. At this time, I'd again like to direct our audience back to the link that has been shared in the chat. This document, the link will send you to the document that's been published on DTSC's website, and there's more information in this document on these six chemicals. In addition, this document contains an extensive list of all of the questions we would like answered for these six chemicals. However, for the sake of time, I have simplified our list of questions to include just a few key questions, which you're now seeing on the slide. These questions include, how are these chemicals used in tires? What is their function and concentration? Are these chemicals considered impurities in tires? Do these chemicals transform within tires, or do they leach from tires? Is additional toxicity and monitoring data available? Have safer alternatives already been evaluated? And at this time, we believe there is clear evidence that exposure in the aquatic environment is occurring, but DTSC needs more data to determine if there is a potential for significant or widespread adverse impacts. Slide 15, please. Thanks so much for your attention during this overview. Again, please visit our website to find additional information on these six chemicals. And the comment period is open now through September 17th. We look forward to hearing from you. At this time, I will turn the presentation back to Jessica. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Taylor. Next slide, please. And one more. Thank you. Okay, so we'll now be taking some questions regarding DTSC's presentation. If you have any questions or comments, please click the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen in the toolbar, and we'll do our best to respond to the questions in the order that we receive them. We will not be using chat function, but if you're joining by phone, please press *9 to raise your hand and let us know you have a question. We'll be prompted to unmute yourself at that time. We ask that you only send one question at a time so that everyone has an opportunity to get their questions asked, or you can send your questions or comments to saferconsumerproducts@dtsc.ca.gov. So our first question reads, do you have evidence that tires represent a major source of these chemicals relative to other sources?
It depends on the chemical, but overall, no, we don't have clear evidence that these tires represent major sources of these chemicals in the environment. We're hoping to solicit this information today through our various stakeholders so we can learn more.
Thank you. So next question we have says, how did you select these chemicals to focus on?
We pulled from a few very recent publications, one being Peter et al. That was published recently. And we've also been keeping an eye on various publications and other data that's coming forward on emerging contaminants in aquatic waterways.
Great. Okay. So next says, if the chemicals are unintentionally added, how are tire manufacturers supposed to keep them out of tires?
We have a data gap here on our knowledge on intentional versus unintentional use. And we hope to work with tire manufacturers to find out more about this information. But right now, I can't really comment on how tire manufacturers would need to keep unintentional chemicals out of their tires.
All righty. Next question says, how will DTSC decide which chemicals to move forward with from the list?
That's a great question. So we need to follow our four-step regulatory process, which mostly relies on data that provides support for these chemicals having significant and widespread adverse impacts. Right now, there's enough data gaps that we can't move forward yet with regulating any of these chemicals. We need to solicit more information on them.
Okay. So it looks like that is all of the questions that we have right now. So what I'm going to do is going to move on to the next presenter. This concludes our Q&A session for DTSC. We will now move on to United States Tire Manufacturing Association. We have Sarah Amig, Jesse Levine, Julie Panko, and Howard Colvin to present. Next slide, please.
Great. Hi, everyone. I'm Jesse Levine. I'm Director of Environment and Safety Regulatory Affairs at the U.S. Tire Manufacturers Association. In today's presentation, we'll be walking through the use, function, and data on other materials identified by DTSC. I'm joined today by my colleague, Sarah Amick, Vice President of EHS&S and Senior Counsel here at USTMA, Howard Colvin, Independent Consultant to USTMA and Expert Polymer Scientist, and Julie Panko, Principal Scientist with Tox Strategies on behalf of USTMA. Next slide. USTMA is a Washington, D.C.-based trade association, and we represent 13 major tire manufacturers that produce tires in the U.S. USTMA members are committed to sustainable practices in every aspect of their businesses. USTMA members embrace a shared responsibility of helping to achieve a more sustainable society. From engineering innovations that reduce CO2 emissions, to enhancing tire safety and performance, driving progress in workplace safety, and preserving the environment throughout the life cycle of a tire, our members are continually looking for new ways to improve the societal contributions of their products and operations. Next slide. So what will we cover today? First, we'll provide an overview of tire materials and tire manufacturing. Next, we'll provide an overview of the extensive research done to evaluate tire materials and tire wear. And we'll also provide an overview of use, function, and data on other materials identified by DTSC, including benzothiazoles, chlorinated paraffins, DPG, methoxymethylmelamines, octylphenol ethoxylates, and PAHs. Next slide. I'd now like to turn it over to Howard Colvin, a polymer scientist expert, to provide an overview of tire materials and tire manufacturing.
Thank you, Jesse. Let's go ahead and turn to the next slide, please. If you were able to be at our last meeting, the tire is asked to do quite a bit. As a consumer, you expect the tire to perform, and you really don't want to think about that. Hopefully, the only time you think about it is when you have to replace them, which hopefully is not very often. But basically, we expect the tire to do a lot of things that are actually contradictory. We expect it to go along the highway and not lose any energy to give us good gas mileage. We don't want that energy converted to heat. But when we stop our car, we want all of the energy of the car to be converted to heat energy so the car will stop. Again, conflicting things. But the tire industry has been able to do that and to do that safely. And that's really the key to what we're trying to do, which we're trying to perform all these functions that you can read here, but do it in a manner that the consumer doesn't have to worry about the safety of the product. Next slide, please. And a comment from one of the OEM engineers regarding his vehicle. He commented that the tire was the most engineered part of a car. And from this slide, you can see why he might say that. We have 10 to 15 different rubber compounds, and these rubber compounds have to be formulated to perform different functions. Each part of the tire is stretched differently. Each part of the tire has different expectations. Some are very hard, some are very soft to give it the ride and the safety that it needs. We use anywhere from 45 to 60 unique materials on each tire. And it's important, not only the materials, but the way that they're put together. But for this presentation, I think that looking at some of the chemicals we'll be discussing, we want to point out that all these things are critical as far as the performance and safety of a tire. Next slide, please. And again, safety is our priority. These are highly regulated products, and they're regulated that way for consumer safety. We're regulated by the NHTSA for new tires and the Safety Act, the 49 USC, with the regulation here. And it's important to realize that if we change the materials, that may very well affect the ability of the tire to meet the standards. And if a tire is changed in any way, whether it be by the manufacturer because he's trying to improve the tire, or whether it's because of legislation, the tire must undergo an incredible amount of testing before it's allowed to be used by the public. Next slide, please. Here's an example of one of the components that we talked about. This is the tread component, and this component has the most rubber of any of the tire components. We use SBR, BR, and natural rubber. And this is the only part of the tire that actually comes in contact with the road. We use carbon black and silica as fillers, and notice the percentage of these over on the right-hand side. We use oils, we use curatives, we use silane and sulfur. One of the chemicals mentioned here for silica compounds, we use DPG, diphenylguanidine, which was mentioned earlier. It's an important component for silica, and silica is a very important component of a tread because it allows you to improve the fuel economy and reduce greenhouse gases. Next slide, please. So I'm going to turn this back over to Julie. If you want to take over from here.
Great. Thanks, Howard. Yes, I'd like to spend just a minute to talk about the tire industry's research done on tire materials recently. So next slide. I mentioned in the zinc presentation that the tire industry has conducted a lot of research on tire and road wear particles over the years, and that's done through the Tire Industry Project under the World Business Council for Sustainable Development. And the research has been extensive on TRWP, looking for chemical markers to identify the particles in the environment, aquatic toxicity testing, mammalian toxicity testing, air sampling. So it's been very extensive. But in addition to researching the TRWP specifically, the industry has also looked at the movement or the potential movement of certain tire materials from the tire and road wear particle. So this work was published by Unis et al. And it characterized the availability and the fate and transport of representative tire materials like the ones that Howard just showed on the previous slide, and to understand those materials as well as their transformation products and where and if they might be released in different environmental compartments. The overall finding from the research was that not all chemicals that go into the mix to make a tire compound or a tread compound specifically are actually present in the TRWP after it's been released. And chemicals and their transformation products and where they end up in the environment is somewhat predictable based on the physical chemical properties of those substances. So thinking about their water solubility, as well as their ability to bind or not bind, as the case might be, to soil and sediment. So I will turn it back to you, Howard. Next slide, please.
Back on here. Next slide here. So let's talk about the overview of these other materials. Next slide, please. Okay, the materials identified by DTSC, the benzothiazole, and as was pointed out in the first presentation, benzothiazole by itself is not used. We do use benzothiazoles in the form of, as was mentioned, mercaptobenzothiazole, as a derivative in sulfenamides, which is a derivative of a benzothiazole. Chlorinated paraffins are not used in tire manufacturing. 1,3-diphenylguanidine is used directly, and it's part of the curing package and is important for silica compounds. The hexamethoxymethylmelamine, HMMM, it is a direct ingredient used in rubber compounds, but typically not in tread compounds. These would be used primarily in internal parts of the tire. The octophenyl ethoxylates, they are not used in tire manufacturing, but I should point out that octophenyl phenol-based resins are used in tire manufacturing to get good cohesion. When they put the pieces of the tire together before they cure it, they have to stick to one another so that the quote-unquote green tire, the uncured tire, stays whole, and these resins are an important part of that. Regarding the PAHs, these can be found in extender oils and carbon blacks. There are regulations regarding PAHs, REACH legislation, which Julie will talk about. We may have some alkylated PAHs in some of our oils, but we'll talk more about that later. Next slide, please. Okay, speaking of the benzothiazoles here, next slide. Okay, we talk about the curing system, and the curing system is composed of sulfur accelerators and activators. And this slide illustrates what we want to get a product, a tire, that will have the safety and the performance required by the consumer. If you take a green tire, and when I mean green tire, I'm talking about a tire that has not been cured. You can take the parts of that tire and stretch them out. I mean, before you cure them, you can simply deform them however you want. And that's illustrated in that picture. You see that blob at the bottom there. That's a polymer that's not cured. And if you were to put that on the surface of the paper, you could watch it flow. It would cold flow. And with sulfur only, in the time period that we use to cure tires, you get very little cure with pure sulfur. If we add the accelerator to that, we get more of a cure, and you can see that in the intermediate line. And to get a tire with the properties that we need for safety and performance, we need the sulfur, the accelerator, and the activator. Now, the curing systems are required to get the right cross-linking, both the amount of cross-linking and the types of cross-links. And the benzothiazoles contribute to the cross-link formation. It plays a very important role. The derivative of benzothiazole that is used in the primary benzothiazole are the sulfenamides. Those materials are used to get a delayed cure. And we'll talk more about that later. That is very important to process the rubber through the entire plant. We take the final green tire and we vulcanize that to give us the product that we all see in the tire stores and that are on our cars today. Next slide, please. Okay, the benzothiazoles, again, it helps create the cross-links that make the rubber compound stables. As I mentioned before, they provide a delay for the cure. And this prevents what we call scorch in the tire industry. If a batch gets scorched, you could be processing it before it gets to the final building, and you can ruin all the rubber. All the rubber could potentially be useless if it cures during the time that it's being processed and before it goes into the tire mold. The benzothiazole derivative, the sulfenamides, help prevent that. Proposed risk evaluation by the Environment and Climate Change Canada found that benzothiazole in tires and road wear particles do not present risk to the environment or human health. And the references are shown here. Next slide, please. And for this, Julie, I'm going to go ahead and turn this over to you, if that's okay.
Yes, absolutely. Thanks. So we are aware of Dr. Chippaway's recent publication regarding the adverse effects that were seen to fathead minnows. I won't try and jump her presentation, but we are aware of that study. And a couple of things to keep in mind. The study overall is a hazard study, meaning they were looking to identify adverse effects in the fathead minnows. In the study, the researchers did not use tire wear test or materials that were representative of tire wear particles, tire and road wear particles. And more importantly, the concentrations that were used to create the leachates from the study are far in excess of anything that is considered environmentally relevant. So using data from that study as well as a companion study, we find that they were having a test solution that was made using about 117,000 tire particles per liter. This is well above the range that SFVI estimated in their study, and certainly above the range of what other authors are indicating as environmentally relevant. So although adverse effects were observed and attributed to benzothiazole compounds, environmental relevance is questionable. Okay, next slide. So this next bit of information is what we have on chlorinated paraffins. And as Howard mentioned, the chlorinated paraffins are not used in tire manufacturing. But we did collect some information. So next slide, please. We looked at the various rubber crumb studies that Alicia mentioned earlier, and we looked at the US EPA crumb rubber study and find that they did not report any detections of CP in their study. And to our knowledge, OEHA has not reported detections of CPs in their study of crumb rubber, although we do realize that the final reports have not yet been published. To my knowledge, there is only one study that I'm aware of that did report CPs in crumb rubber, and that was by authors from the Netherlands, Brandsma et al. And their conclusion, well, first of all, they studied end-of-life tires or scrap tires, as we call them here in the U.S., as well as rubber crumb. And their conclusion was that the CPs were detectable, but they were at such small concentrations, less than 0.007% by weight, that they hypothesized that the CPs could have gotten there through some sort of contamination in some sort of manufacturing process. So that's what we know on the chlorinated paraffins. Next slide, please. So Howard also mentioned DPG, and so we'll talk a little bit about what we know about DPG. So next slide, please. As he mentioned, DPG is part of the curing system. It works as a secondary accelerator, again, in those silica-based tread compounds. And those silica-based tread compounds really do a nice job of providing better fuel economy for our cars and also a reduction in greenhouse gases. So those have become an important advancement in entire technology. In the Eunice et al. Study, we did evaluate DPG, and we found that the majority of DPG is consumed during vulcanization. Most of the accelerators are mostly consumed. We found that about 7% of the original DPG that's put into the mix is available for release from the TRWP initially when it's generated, and that the amount decreases over time and was not detectable after about one and a half years. Okay, next slide. And I think this goes back to you, Howard.
Thanks, Julie. Okay, next is the hexamethoxymethylmelamines. And we could go to the next slide. And this is an ingredient. It is an ingredient in tire manufacturing. And what it does, it makes a network, a three-dimensional network, which is in the rubber. And what this does is these are used in components of the rubber typically, which are very hard. It's a way to make the rubber much harder. It's not used in tread compounds usually. I think one out of 13 of our members uses it in tread compounds. We feel that the migration from the internal tire components is unlikely due to the resin formation. So again, we're open to that, but based on the structure of the resin, we wouldn't expect too much migration of that material. Next slide, please. Some of the sources of HMM to the environment, and I think this first one is one that we should emphasize. Much of the HMM comes from paints and coatings, vehicle clear coats, and this is identified by HMM manufacturers as their largest markets. Again, you can see these other markets here, but we'd like to emphasize that the paints and coatings area are some of the major users of HMM. Next slide, please. Okay, the octyl phenol ethoxylates. And Julie, I'm going to turn this back over to you.
Okay, great. Next slide, please. As Howard mentioned, at the beginning of this presentation, the OPEs are not used in tire manufacturing. Octyl phenol, however, is a chemical intermediate that is used in making octyl phenol-based tackifier resins. And Howard described that the use of those resins is to keep different parts, components of the tire together during manufacturing. So we don't have data on octyl phenol ethoxylates since they are not used. But I wanted to point out that a recent study by Tian et al., which is a study we'll talk about tomorrow in the 6PPD call, did test pure OP in the juvenile coho salmon and did not find toxicity in terms of the urban runoff mortality symptoms, and it did not induce mortality in that species. Next slide. Okay, so the next and possibly last category is the polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons. Next slide, please. As Howard mentioned, the PAHs can be present in the extender oils that are used in tire manufacturing. The point of those extender oils is to ensure proper viscosity, meaning they need to be able to flow through the manufacturing process. In 2010, a regulation came into place in Europe under the REACH regulations that restricted the use of high aromatic extender oils in tires. And this regulation specifically restricts the amount of 8 different PAHs in the oils. While that regulation is not in place here, all USTMA members manufacture their tires in accordance with the EU regulation with respect to using low PAH containing oils. Next slide. So DTSC in the background document asked some questions regarding PAHs in carbon black. And we just wanted to remind you that the carbon black is used as a reinforcing filler in tires, and it can contain trace levels of PAHs. We're not aware of studies that have demonstrated the release of PAHs necessarily coming from carbon black. Ham et al. In 2009, I have a study listed here, did evaluate the incorporation of carbon black into a rubber matrix and found that the PAHs were not migrating to water-type solutions, things that might represent exposure media for humans like sweat or saliva or rainwater for environmental media. Next slide. DTSC also asked if there was information about the aquatic toxicity of PAHs in carbon black. And to our knowledge, there is no toxicity data that's specifically related to PAHs from carbon black. We've reviewed the ECHA-REACH dossier for carbon black and note that it contains many studies, aquatic toxicity studies, none of which really showed any signs of toxicity. There were many acute studies done, and because carbon black is not soluble in water, there really was no toxicity all the way up to the highest test concentrations. Next slide. Okay, so I think I'll turn this back to Jesse.
Excellent. Thanks, Julie. So to conclude, I want to summarize the key points we made in this presentation, which correlate with the regulatory criteria. For chlorinated paraffins, these substances are not used in tire manufacturing by USTMA members. For octyl phenol ethoxylates, these are not used in tire manufacturing. While OP-based resins are used, the TAN study tested pure OP and did not find adverse impacts on coho salmon. For methoxymethylmelamines, HMM, the potential for release from tread is extremely low due to the primary use in interior tire components. For benzothiazoles, Environment and Climate Change Canada recently proposed a risk evaluation and found no risk from benzothiazoles in tire wear. For PAHs, USTMA members are in compliance voluntarily with the existing EU restriction on PAHs in extender oils. And for DPG, the majority of the substance is reacted during vulcanization and presence in tire and roadwear particles are not detectable after 1.5 years. We want to thank DTSC for the opportunity to provide information today. We will be providing additional information in written comments, and we're happy to take questions.
Thank you for that. So we'll now be taking some questions regarding USTMA's presentation. So if you have any questions, please click the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. Once again, you're welcome to email your questions or comments or press star nine to raise your hand to let us know you have a question and you'll be called on and prompted to unmute. Okay, so the first question that we have says, have tire manufacturers specifically tested for OPEs or OPs as a contaminant in tires?
I'll direct that question. So in 2012, EPA listed octyl phenol, 4-tert octyl phenol, as a potential priority chemical under TSCA. And we did do some evaluations at that time, looking at whether there was any residual octyl phenol from the use of octyl phenol-based resins. So we're not adding 4-tert octyl phenol to tires. It's a residual chemical in resins. And we found very, very low amounts of that substance. I don't know, Julie, if you want to add anything to that.
No, I think that's about it.
Okay. So next question says, have tire manufacturers evaluated safer alternatives to DPG based on the toxicity reported by REACH?
I'm not aware of any activity in that area. I don't know, Julie, if you can speak to anything on that.
No, I'm not.
Okay. So I'll move on to the next question, which says, are PAHs outside of the 8 identified in the EU REACH legislation used in extender oils?
I'm not sure I understand the question.
I'll repeat it one more time. It says, are PAHs outside of the 8 identified in the EU REACH legislation used in extender oils?
I don't have information today to provide to that, but it's something we can consider and include in our written comments.
Okay, thank you. So moving on, the next question says, is the fact that DPG is not present in tire particles after 1.5 years not of concern? And does this suggest leaching or transformation into potential toxic products?
I think a lot of the research around DPG was done by the World Business Council for Sustainable Development Tire Industry Project. So I'm going to turn to Julie to shed a little bit more light on that research.
Yep, absolutely. So the findings of that study were that that DPG was mostly consumed in the vulcanization process because it really wasn't it was detected, but not by a lot in tire and roadwear particles. The main transformation product for DPG is aniline. And in that UNICEF et al. Study, we tracked both DPG and aniline and found that they can be present in different environmental compartments. There was one part of the study involved sediment incubators where we looked to see where the chemicals would partition, whether it stayed in the sediment, whether it went to the pore water, or whether it went to the overlying water. And so that study shows the movement of those two chemicals.
Thank you. Next question says, you presented one study in COHO showing that OP is not toxic, but this does not take into consideration that OP may be toxic to other aquatic organisms. Do you think one toxicity study is sufficient to make a conclusion about toxicity?
I mean, we make tires. We don't make octyl phenol or octyl phenol ethoxylate, so I would defer to the chemical manufacturers to provide more information on that.
Okay, so next question says, what kind of materials would you propose to use that would be representative of tire wear test materials in tire leachin hazard studies?
So that's a great question. Obviously the gold standard of what's representative of what's in the environment are tire and road wear particles. As we mentioned earlier, tire wear exists as both a particle that's a piece of the tire tread and also encrusted with minerals from the road, but that can be difficult to generate and also quite costly. So the World Business Council for Sustainable Development Tire Industry Project has created a methodology that's publicly available on their website called the Cryomill Tire Tread Methodology. And that would be our recommendation for what to use in order to study something that would be representative of the size of how tire wear exists in the environment.
Okay. Thank you for that question. Looks like we may have another question coming in. It says, is there any data regarding the amount of these six chemicals present in chrome rubber produced from vehicle tires?
I don't have the data off the top of my head, but the EPA study part one is publicly available. And I believe OEHA has published a lot of their findings as well from the information that they put on their website.
Okay, I don't see any other questions. I'll give one more moment. All right, we got another one that says, is there more recent data than the 2009 study you cite that found no leaching from PAHs from carbon black in the rubber matrix?
I'll defer to Julie to respond to that question.
Not that I'm aware of. I haven't specifically looked recently, but not that I'm aware of.
Okay, so this is kind of a long one, so bear with me. So it says, I think that's pronounced Solario, et cetera, all 2020 results revealed that the presence of most of the target PAHs in chrome rubber at total concentration up to 57, and it says, next to a high number of plasticizers, the vulcanization agents, runoff water, collected from the football pitches contained up to 13 PAHs as well as other chemicals of concern. In addition to continuous leaching of chemicals from the chrome rubber to the surrounding water was demonstrated. The transfer of target chemicals into the runoff water poses a potential risk for aquatic environment. So it looks like that was more of a comment than necessarily a question. But we do have another question that just came in. It says, chlorinated paraffins have been identified in chrome rubber, which is made from tires. If your manufacturers don't use chlorinated paraffins in their tires, how did these chems end up in chrome rubber that is made up from recycled tires?
That's a great question. I don't know. We don't add chlorinated paraffins to tires. They are not used by our members in manufacturing tires. So I have no idea how they ended up there.
Okay, so looks like we have a little bit of time. I'll give one more minute for anyone else that wants to make any questions or comments. Okay, we'll go ahead and move on then. This concludes our Q&A session for the United States Tire Manufacturers Association's presentation. I'll now invite Dr. Andy Booth from SINTEF to present.
Hi, good afternoon. I think it's evening here in Norway, quite late. Thanks very much for the invitation. It actually went to one of my colleagues, Claudia Halsbond, who is shown on this front slide. But it's the holiday season here in Norway, so I was the main person available. So you get me. So I'm going to just take you through some of the studies that we've been doing over a period of a number of years now, maybe 5-6 years. A little condensed version of some of the things that we found along the way from both a chemical characterization, a leaching and toxicology perspective. It's not everything that's we've done, of course, and and I really, really wish we have a lovely study done now in our labs on fish embryo development, where we've looked at benzothiazole, 6-PPD, a full car tire extract to try and pull out what's happening, but those data weren't ready. You'll have to wait for those for another time. Next slide, please, 52. So just a bit, you've probably all well aware of the sort of background with tires, but the estimates are that approximately 1.5 kilograms of a brand new tire's weight is lost during its use. That's when the tire becomes worn down and you need to replace it. And then you have this issue of end of life tires, and the term crumb rubber has come up quite a few times in the questions, at least just now. And that was what initially got us into this in Norway. It's not the sort of driest of countries. It's very cold. There's long winters. So we have a lot of artificial sports fields. That's where we started conducting our research. So please be aware, and I think this is very important given what's been said in the previous study, is that quite a lot of the data that I'm going to show is based on crumb rubber rather than tire wear particles. We're increasingly shifting over to tire wear particles as it's being considered a form of microplastic, and that's another of our strong research areas. But of course, as we saw in the previous presentation, the tread and the walls of the tire, two different things. And of course, when they're producing crumb from end of life tires, there's a high proportion of non-tread material that's used to make that product. Next slide, please. 53. Yeah. So we've worked from the principle of trying to look at what is present in the sort of raw material, what is leaching, and then trying to look at the toxicity of that, and also set it in the context of other plastic and rubber materials that might end up in the environment as litter. Zinc is obviously a topic here, but what we did a sort of a broad scan of metals, and we found quite a broad range of metals present in both new and what we call collected infill. This is crumb rubber that's been out for an unspecified period of time. So you can see that, you know, there's a focus on zinc, but there's other things that are present. Mostly I'll be focusing on organics today. Next slide, 54, please. So when we are looking at the organic chemicals in car tire rubber, we typically look at we do a solvent extract. We use a variety of different solvent combinations. And then a combination, we primarily use gas chromatography, but increasingly we're also using LCMS analysis to cover a broader range of chemical types. So this gives us a baseline of what is in the actual materials that we're working with. Slide 55, please. This is from crumb rubber. And on the top, you see gas chromatogram. Every peak there represents an individual compound. For those of you not familiar with how gas chromatography works, normally what you would see is a flat line at the bottom and then peaks sticking out at the top. What you can actually see here is what we call an unresolved complex mixture, a kind of hump in the baseline, and that is where you have so many chemicals present that you can't get separation of the individual chemicals from each other. So they just form this one big hump. So the actual chemical profile in the materials is really, really complex. I picked out a couple here, the benzothiazole and also benzothiazolone. Those we'll pick up in a minute, but on the top left, there's 6 PPD. And these are some of the other chemicals that we were able to identify. And that's a key thing here that I'd want to point out, is that when you're working blind like this, you're doing what we call non-target analysis to try and find out what is there. You're dependent on matching mass spectra generated for each of these peaks, each of these chemicals, against what is available in a library. And if that chemical is not registered in the library, you're not going to get a match. So please bear in mind that we're far from able to identify all of the components in a way that we would consider robust. However, some we were, including these ones here. Slide 56, please. Just a little nod to the pHs. Those have been mentioned. We did find pHs, in particular these ones, in the materials that we were working with. When we come to the leachates, I'll just mention again, we found very little evidence for significant leaching of these chemicals. And that's not unsurprising. We have a really strong background in oil pollution, actually. So we're very, very familiar with working with pHs in all of their different analogs and homologs and functionalized groups. And yeah. And it's not unsurprising. These are big hydrophobic chemicals, and they don't have very very much water solubility. Slide 57, please. So when we're looking at, we predominantly work in a marine environment. The clue is in the SINTEF Ocean Institute name. So when we generate leachates, we often do it in seawater. We do use freshwater for some studies. And the general approach is that we work at room temperature, we expose the material for 14 days ambient in the dark. That's pretty important because we don't want the leach chemicals to photodegrade, at least immediately. Then we go through a filtration and analysis process. Slide 58. So the first thing that I want to go back to is the top chromatogram that you see here. This is from the solvent extract. The chromatogram underneath is the leachate, seawater leachate. And you can see that the profiles are massively shifted. That hump has disappeared, or at least is so reduced that it looks like a baseline. And not unsurprisingly, the lower molecular weight chemicals, such as benzothiazole and the 2,3-H benzothiazolone, they are quite water soluble. We find those in higher concentrations than virtually all other chemicals. So you might expect that, you know, the top chromatogram is going to produce this sort of massive cocktail of chemicals in the leachate, but it's not necessarily the case. In the studies that we've done, we've identified 16 compounds where we're pretty happy with the identification. That doesn't mean there aren't more compounds there. That's just the ones that we were comfortable or confident with the identification. Slide 59. Yes. I don't want to sort of jump the gun too much for tomorrow's session, but I did want to mention 6 PPD. This is a hot chemical at the moment, as everybody knows. We did some quick analyses on some of our materials and in the leachates. We looked at the parent compound, the 6 PPD, and also the quinone metabolite that is the one that was primarily identified as driving the acute mortality in the coho salmon. We found both 6 PPD and the quinone present in at least our materials, and they're also present in low levels in the leachates. Next slide, please, 60. So when it comes to the bioavailability of associated chemicals, or chemicals associated with any sort of solid material, there's two primary exposure routes. You have what we consider aqueous leaching. That's the one that most people are focused on. This is where you have leaching of the chemicals. I've just got bisphenol A as an example. It's nothing to do with CTR. It's a recycled slide. You have leaching of these chemicals into aqueous media, and then they're taken up, or the organism is exposed in the dissolved phase, and they're taken up that way. And depending on the chemical, they can concentrate or accumulate in tissues and organs. Next animation, please. The other route that is put forward quite a lot, certainly within the microplastic field, I'm not so sure it's so prevalent when it comes to tire and road wear particles, but is this issue, if you have ingestion of particles by the organism, and as the particles are passing through the gut, that you have a sort of a leaching there, and exposure through that route. There's a lot of uncertainty around this, and my personal feeling is that this ingestion route is largely negligible. any organism that is going to be, it's negligible for chemicals adsorbed to the surface. It could be more potentially relevant for things like tire air particles, where it's chemicals that are present in the actual particle. But it's very, very complex and complicated, because trying to put these particles into water and then do an exposure means you're getting leaching immediately, and both exposure routes happen. So it is challenging. Next slide, 61, please. I'm just going to go through a few of the tox studies that we've done. This is one that we've had ongoing at the moment. It's looking at three trophic levels of, of marine organisms. We've got copepods at the bottom of the marine food web, at least bottom of the predatory food web. It's Norway. We took a commercially important species, which was a northern shrimp or prawn. One that was relevant for aquaculture, we took the lumpfish. They're used as cleaner fish on salmon that are infected with salmon lice. Next slide, please, 62. So here we generated cartile rubber leachates from crumb rubber. We saw for two different copepod species, we saw that there was an effect on the growth or the size of the organism at quite high concentrations. But you need to have quite high concentrations of leachate to generate an effect. Next slide, 63. Yeah. The rubber ingestion and contaminant in the tissues we're looking at in prawns and lumpfish, those have been exposed to crumb rubber that is included in their food source. And we've been through a process of dissecting the guts and intestines to look for rubber ingestion. You'll see that in a second. And then we're in the process right now of doing the contaminant concentrations in the tissues. And there we are looking at these tissues for the prawns, the hepatopancreas, the tail muscle, and then the blood and the liver for the lumpfish. Slide 64, please. So these are the prawns. And you can see in the bottom right-hand side, we get particles ingested. And this is crumb rubber, so these are quite large particles. This is a couple of millimetres up to 3-4 millimetres maybe in size, some of these particles are being ingested. Next slide, not sure of the number, 65, yes. The same with the lumpfish. Sorry about the gruesome pictures, but you can see here that, again, the lumpfish ingested the rubber particles, and we can see them in the intestine. Slide 66, please. We've been doing the 6 ppd analysis so far, and that's been detected in the shrimp muscle tissue and the lumpfish blood and liver tissue. Still to come is the benzothiazole and the zinc analysis, so I don't have those to show right now. Next slide, please, 67. Another study that we did compared CTR or the rubber granulate with 4 different thermoplastic polymers, PVC, polypropylene, PET, polystyrene. Here we did leaching into fresh water. We did our chemical analysis both before and after the leaching process to see what was there and then what leached. And then we did a primary toxicity study using a freshwater and a seawater algae to test the toxicity of the different leachates. Slide 68, please. Try and jump through these. Please note this is identified organic chemicals, so it's not the most valuable slide, but it does still indicate that certain of the test materials had more chemicals present, at least. And across the different materials, we saw plasticizers, antioxidants, antimicrobials, etc. 69, please, slide. We found in general, these are basically toxicity graphs where we've determined EC50 values. So that's a concentration that affects 50% of the population. This was growth of the algae. and clear standouts in terms of toxicity were the car tire rubber and PVC. There was no toxicity from the PET. We saw species differences, it does appear to some degree that toxicity is linked to the high chemical content that we saw in PVC and SBR, but not the case for the PP. So I think, you know, it is more likely to be the type of compounds at present. Slide 70, please. Then we've done most recently a much broader toxicity comparison. Please bear in mind that this study was, the main focus is actually not car tire rubber. It's just one of many, many materials that we worked with. It was for a plastics project. It was over 50 products in the end. This is some of them. And it includes rubbers and thermoplastics and latex, all sorts of products. Slide 71, please. I won't go into a lot of detail. This is a huge amount of data, but the methanol extracts with the highest toxicity were included the car tire rubber, but things like vinyl flooring, balloons, dishwashing gloves, disposable plastic gloves. So what we found was quite a lot of, which was interesting for us, quite a lot of the rubber and latex materials that we included in our group fell into this category. And I think the one that worried us the most was probably the disposable plastic gloves, which is probably a topic for another time. But given COVID, this is something that has been used extensively. And then just some examples of things that were not so toxic. This was using two different tests. It was a bacteria luminescence test and a microalgae tox test. Slide 72, please. So, the conclusions that we've drawn from across our different studies, and again, I've presented just a snapshot very quickly here. CTR, car tire rubber, contains hundreds of different chemicals and metals. And we see that the corresponding leachates, seawater, freshwater, they also contain a good number of chemicals and metals, certainly not the same as actually in the product, depending on the chemical properties themselves. The CTR leachates are toxic to a range of different organisms that we've tested, different types of toxicity endpoints, and that CTR toxicity is high compared to quite a lot of other plastic products. Overall, our feeling is that there's no clear correlation between the number of chemicals and toxicity. So we really are looking for individual chemicals that are driving certain toxicological responses in a certain species, which makes it more complicated. And someone asked earlier about, like, is one toxicity test good enough to make a decision? No, it's not, in my opinion, at least. You need multiple species, multiple toxicological endpoints to actually really understand, you know, what the toxicity is and how impactful a particular chemical is. So that's me. Thank you very much for your time. I'll happily take any questions. Oh, yeah, and these are all my wonderful projects, collaborators, and funders.
Thank you, Dr. Booth. Next slide, please. Thank you. We'll now be taking some questions regarding Dr. Booth's presentation. So if you have any questions or comments, please click the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen in the toolbar. You can also email your questions or comments to Safer Consumer Products at DTSC.ca.gov or press *9 to raise your hand and let us know you have a question if you're calling by phone. Once again, you'll be called upon and prompted to unmute yourself. So the first question that we have says, you've been investigating saltwater species. Any idea whether freshwater species beyond algae might be more or less sensitive or whether there would be more leaching into the different waters?
Okay, so that's good questions there. We don't particularly work with freshwater species. Sometimes we work with Daphnia magna. They're so easy to keep in the lab. We haven't worked with Daphnia magna on any of our leachate studies. So I don't think I can actually answer that one honestly in terms of whether it's more toxic or not to freshwater species. Often what we see is, regardless of whether an organism is freshwater or marine, the if they're related at a biological level, i.e. a planktonic species, you know, zooplanktonic species, freshwater and marine, there's often at least some similarity in terms of toxicological response. In terms of what goes into leachates, freshwater versus seawater, that's interesting. We definitely see very little difference when it comes to organic chemicals, actually. The leachate profiles are largely the same for freshwater and seawater. Different for metals, though. The salinity plays a key role in the dissolution of metals.
Okay, thank you. Next question says, are there other chemicals outside of the six that are discussed today that DTSC should be interested in based on your research?
I have to admit, I was quite curious because in the previous presentation, I think if I remember or understood correctly, benzothiazole itself is not known to be directly added or used as an ingredient. Yet that's something that it's one of the chemicals that we find in high concentration all the time in CTR products. So I was curious about that one. I know it's kind of on that list of six. Others, it's a bit hard. Right now, I think we're personally working towards trying to identify some of these chemicals and then buy in the pure chemical and run those alongside each other. Like we do, like I mentioned, with this test we have going on now on fish embryo development. There we have the 6 PPD. I think we used the quinone in that experiment. We have benzothiazole and we have CTR full leachate to see if we can pick out, what chemicals are driving which toxicological endpoint. And we tested for a few different endpoints. What I can say off the top of my head is that we saw different toxicological response from benzothiazole and 6 PPD. So the 6 PPD, if I remember correctly, caused more developmental abnormalities, whereas the benzothiazole caused more mortality. And that was quite interesting when we linked that back up to the overall leachate.
Okay, looks like we have one final question. It says, you have tested leachate from car tire rubber and extract from other consumer products. Do you know which particular chemicals in each solution might be toxic? And if you suspect any chemical to be more toxic, do you know which one and explain the rationale?
Oh, that's a tough question. The simple answer is no. It's something that the slightly longer answer is that we were very curious to see what type of chemicals were in all of these different products. There was a surprising lack of overlap, actually. It's often quite specific and different chemicals, certainly within each type of plastic. So even polyethylene compared to PET, compared to PVC, you know, they're all different. And of course, the CTR is the same. So they're all dominated by different chemicals and there's not so much overlap. So picking out an individual one is pretty tough, actually. And just from the chemistry alone, we can analyze a leachate, we can analyze what's in a material, but that tells us nothing about what is driving the toxicity. It could be one small low-level chemical that is highly toxic, that is causing the toxicity. And yet, you know, it's very tempting to focus on the chemicals that are present in high concentration. So it's part of what we call effects-directed analysis. It's something that we're starting to embark on now, where we try and work, you know, focusing on what exactly is driving the observed toxicity. So sorry I couldn't answer that one a little better. I hope to be able to do it in the next couple of years.
There is a clarifying question. Are you referring to 6 PPD or 6 PPD quinone?
In the fish embryo studies that we've done at the moment, which I haven't presented today, that's the quinone. We have both chemicals in-house. And as you saw in the study here, we were looking for the 6 PPD. We will probably also put the quinone in on the analyses if we have enough resources to do that. But it's okay. Quite important to differentiate between the two, I think.
Sorry, just for time's sake, we have kind of two related questions, and this will be our last one. It says, is this study published and how was your CTR collected?
Okay, so elements of what I've shown today have been published. Elements are in the process of being published, and some stuff, as I say, this is a mix of different studies that we've published in recent years. What was the second half of the question?
How was your CTR collected and if it was published?
Yeah, so the CTR we got from two sources, well, multiple sources actually, but we got three different grades from a producer in Norway called Wagon Cells. They actually receive end-of-life tyres and produce this material. So we had sort of fresh chrome rubber. And then we actually, I'm based in Trondheim. A couple of our colleagues are based up in Tromsø, right up in the north of Norway. And we both went out and sampled chrome rubber from artificial football pitches for curiosity more than anything. But most of the work, virtually all the work we've done has been with pristine chrome rubber direct from source.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Booth. This concludes our Q&A session on your presentation. So we'll now invite Dr. Kelly Peter of the National Institute of Standards and Technology to present. Dr. Peter?
Thanks, Jessica. So my name is Kathy Peter, and I'm going to be sharing some data today about these tire-derived contaminants in stormwater and in urban creeks. If we could go to slide 76. So first, just some introductions and acknowledgements of the many other folks who have contributed to this data. I also wanted to mention that I currently am at NIST, but the data that I'm showing is from my time at Ed Kolodziej's lab at the University of Washington, Tacoma, and the Center for Urban Waters. Let's go to slide 77. So to start with just giving context for our stormwater research at the Center for Urban Waters, this urban runoff mortality syndrome, or URMS, has been mentioned a couple times by the previous presenters and is an impact from urban stormwater where adult coho salmon die in these Seattle area urban creeks upon exposure to urban stormwater within just a few hours. And the toxicant driving this very species-specific effect has been unknown for over a decade now. And so that question of what is the toxic chemical in urban stormwater has been sort of the key research question in our lab. Next slide, 78. Of course, we now know the answer to that question, and that's going to be the focus of tomorrow's workshop on 6-PPD quinone. And the Tian et al. Paper published in Science this year has been shown also by the previous presenters. But as we've been working towards that identification of 6-PPD quinone, we've also learned a lot about stormwater and specifically other tire-derived chemicals in stormwater. And so that is going to be the data that I'm sharing today. Next slide, 79. So one of our early approaches to trying to figure out which chemicals and which sources were important with respect to this coho mortality syndrome was to analyze many different water samples where we knew that coho mortality had occurred and essentially define a chemical signature or a chemical fingerprint for the mortality syndrome based on all the detections from all of those distinct waters. And so this included lab exposures using roadway runoff, as well as field waters where citizen scientists had observed coho actively dying from urban runoff mortality syndrome. And these samples were all analyzed by liquid chromatography paired to high resolution mass spectrometry. So doing sort of a broad screening, non-targeted analysis. And there were 57 chemicals that overlapped between all of these different waters. And that defined our chemical signature that we could then use to compare against new waters, evaluate sources, and think about treatment system performance, for example. Next slide, 80. So one of the things that we asked about the mortality signature is simply what is in it? And we were able to identify about half of the compounds that are in the signature, but that accounted for more than 3/4 of the total peak area in a given water sample. So the pie chart here is showing the breakdown of that peak area for one of our field water samples from Miller Creek, which is in the Seattle, Washington area during a URMS event. And so looking on the left side of the pie chart, you can see there's a group of unknowns that we just couldn't identify. There's also this group of surfactants, so the polypropylene and polyethylene glycols, as well as a small slice of the pie accounting for octyl phenolophosphates. And so some of these we've also detected in tire leach shape, but as has been mentioned, surfactants are used in many other sources. So these are very much less source specific relative to, for example, the chemicals on the right-hand side of the pie chart. So looking at that right-hand side, we first saw a group of bicyclic amines. And so this included chemicals like dicyclohexylurea, which is an industrial precursor and is also found in tire leachate, as well as diphenylguanidine, that rubber vulcanization accelerator that's been mentioned many times now. There also was a family of these methoxymethylmelamines, or MMMs. The main compound in that MMM family was hexamethoxymethylmelamine, or HMMM. We also saw four other family members with it that had differences in those methoxymethyl arms coming off of that melamine core. Next slide, 81. I want to share a bit of data specific to that HMMM family. This chart is showing the profile of the HMMM family where peak area is normalized with to that of that HMMM, so the main component, and then all the other family members stacked on top of that gray component, that gray HMMM portion in other colors. If we look first at the far left-hand side, we can see data for this this MMM family from tire wear particle leachates. And I'll note that these are direct tire wear particles, so scraped off of the tread of a tire rather than being tire and road wear particles. So they're not TRWP, they're just TWP. And there's this consistent profile in those leachates. And, you know, there's the USTMA folks mentioned how MMMs are used. They actually said they're not added to rubber. I'd seen a patent saying that they are added to rubber, but generally they're used to promote tire tread adhesion to the tire cords. And so I'd love to learn more about how they're added to different tire formulations. Somehow though, the HMMM family is then getting out into urban waters. So across the rest of the plot, we see data from either direct roadway runoff or urban surface waters during storm events, where we have this really consistent chemical fingerprint that sort of points back to this link to this family coming from tire wear particles and leaching out. In terms of concentration, we were seeing concentration of HMMM specifically up to about 20 micrograms per liter in direct roadway runoff, and then up to about 2 micrograms per liter in surface waters or receiving waters. More recent data, both in Germany and in Canada, has sort of echoed those same concentration ranges for surface waters. And in Germany, they also have been seeing this broader family where there's not just those additional 5 that I mentioned or 4 that I mentioned in the family. There's also many others that are either transformation products or are somehow part of a technical mixture potentially that's being added to tires. We really don't know. Next slide, 82. So from a lot of this work that we did screening tire wear particle leachates and screening stormwater, we had a lot of chemicals that we were seeing over and over again. And so based on that information, as well as data from the literature about what chemicals are in stormwater, we built a LC tandem mass spec stormwater method where we could quantify the concentrations of 35 chemicals from the 6 main classes that are shown here. And so the data I'm going to be showing on the next few slides is about all of these classes of chemicals, but does include that corrosion inhibitor group with the benzothiazoles and benzotriazoles as well, and the tire-derived chemicals like HMMM and DPG. Next slide, 83. So one of the research questions that we wanted to ask using that targeted stormwater method was to understand better when water quality degrades during storm events in urban creeks with respect to these emerging organic contaminants. This could help us understand whether there are potentially time periods during storm events, so across the course of a storm hydrograph, that might be priorities for stormwater management. And so our approach was to sample before, during, and after storm events. We focused on Miller Creek, which is in Washington State in the United States in the Puget Sound area, where there's documented urban runoff mortality syndrome. So you can see 2 of these storm events in 2018 that were sampled. We specifically found dead fish during and after those storm events. Slide 84, please. So first, just showing a snapshot comparison between baseload conditions on the left and a snapshot of the highest concentrations detected during each of these three storm events on the right. In terms of the targeted chemical classes that we were looking for, you can see that loads are about an order of magnitude higher during storm events relative to the late summer dry season base flow conditions. This is also reflected in the concentrations for the specific benzothiazoles, benzotriazoles, HMMM, and DPG that are shown at the bottom of the slide, where the concentration on the left is from the base flow condition, typically ranging between, 50 to 100 nanograms per liter, and then concentrations on the right during storm events, where concentrations are up in that 500 to even 2000 nanogram per liter range. Next slide, 85. So now, coming out from that snapshot of concentration, we can look at the overall contaminant profile over the course of the storm event. And so the term that we use for describing that, that concentration profile is the pollutograph. And so comparing on the bottom, the hydrograph, so the storm flow, where we have a really sharp profile where the flow and the peak rapidly rises and then rapidly falls again. The pollutograph shown in the top half of the slide shows a much broader shape where there's this extended time period that contaminant transport is happening over the course of the storm event. Next slide, 86. I want to focus in on two portions of the hydrograph and the pollutograph. So first, using the October storm as an example, we have this really rapid first flush of contaminants into the creek. So you can see in the bottom that the hydrograph is barely just starting to rise. So it's actually really just drizzling in the watershed with very limited active runoff. But concentrations shown in the top plot are already very high and elevated. And so that points to this existence of these really high strength, flashy contaminant sources in the watershed. Next slide, 87. As we move through the storm event, though, as we move into the storm peak and even after that storm peak is passed, we're not seeing dilution. So there's higher flow, but the contaminant concentrations are continuing to increase. And so this points to really large mass loads entering the creek at the storm peak. And so what this tells us about these contaminant classes, which include the tire-derived chemicals in blue and especially in green, that these chemicals are what we think of as transport limited rather than mass limited. And so next slide, 88. I want to use a couple of the tire-derived chemicals, HMMM and DPG, to describe what that transport limited behavior might mean. Because it points to the fact that we potentially have semi-infinite reservoirs of contaminant mass in these types of urban watersheds. And so the calculation that's shown on the slide is basically moving from concentration observed during the storm event in the creek for these two chemicals, HMMM and DPG, converting that into loads using the storm flow data, and then combining that with information about the mass of HMMM and DPG that leaches out of tireware particles from studies done in our lab. And when we put those pieces of information together, we can calculate that the mass of tireware particles needed to explain these observed storm event loads would be potentially up to 1,600 kilograms of tireware particles, or 8 million vehicle miles traveled. And in terms of this watershed, 8 million vehicle miles traveled for a given storm event is not practical. And so instead, that means that we have essentially reservoirs of contaminants, thinking of potentially tireware particles that are in pipes or in sediments that are just able to be leached as stormwater is running off and entering the receiving water. And data from the literature, this is data from a Eunice et al. Study in 2013, does support this in terms of the observed loads of tireware particles in freshwater sediments. Next slide, 89. So just wrapping up, our data shows that these tire-derived chemicals are really prevalent and very high abundance in small urban systems, but we just don't have a lot of ecotoxicity data about most of them. The data also show that there are opportunities for disproportionate impacts, but also strategies for management in terms of, for example, those early small volumes of stormwater or managing these contaminant reservoirs like tireware particles that may exist in urban systems. So with that, I'd be happy to take questions.
Thank you, Dr. Peter. Okay, so that concludes Dr. Peter's presentation. So now it's time for the Q&A. Again, if you have a question or comment, click on the Q&A or email Safer Consumer Products at dtsc.ca.gov. And if by phone you have a question, please press *9 to let us know you have a question. First one says, after the flush of compounds into the water, are these chemicals transported further downstream or are they degraded in the water column or settled into the sediments?
That's a great question. I don't have data about that, really. The only data that I have is from that same watershed. We've sampled along the length of that watershed, Miller Creek, and seen that the concentrations of, for example, HMMM and DPG from the point in the watershed where they start being elevated, they pretty much stay the same concentration. But that's sampling over a very limited time period. So we just don't have a lot of data about their persistence and where they end up.
Thank you. Next question says, why are you limiting the HMMM found in stormwater runoff to tire wear particles when HMMM manufacturers have identified vehicle clear coating as the largest market for HMMM?
So we haven't had the opportunity to analyze vehicle coatings. What I can say is that, you know, based on the profile of that HMMM family of chemicals that we've seen, the profile in leachate from tire wear particles and what we've observed in receiving waters is very similar. But we obviously have not done a full accounting of the total loads from various sources of those, that MMM family.
Okay. Next question says, was the scrap tire treads used in your study from used tires? And if so, could some of the chemicals like HMMM be picked up by the tire from the road, auto coating or clear coating, and contaminated your results, not from tires?
So the tires used in our study were a mix of used and new tires. It is possible that components of the road are on some of those used tires. We haven't analyzed them individually.
Okay, next question says, for the HMMM family, are the other MMM compounds degradation or transformation products of HMMM? Or are they different parent compounds that may have been added to tires? Do you know which or which?
So I don't know for sure which or which, and I don't know for sure if the other chemicals are added to tires. I have seen them mentioned in patents, but I don't know what that translates to in practice. I think the USTMA folks would be best able to answer that question. There was another part of the question.
Yeah, it says, are they from different parent compounds?
Oh, I got, okay, yeah, sorry. It's hard when you can't see the questions to remember. So there is some data showing that the other members of the family can form as transformation products, but we just don't have a way to know whether the ones that we're seeing in our water samples are the result of transformation or are entering as the parent compounds themselves.
Great, thank you. Next question says, so it could take years or decades for stormwater to flush the toxics and sequester, assuming we find out and stop adding to the toxic reservoir.
I think we really don't have the data to answer that question.
Okay. Sarah Amick, looks like she has a question.
Thank you, Dr. Peter. What technologies are you aware of today that can mitigate materials in roadway runoff?
So when you say materials in roadway runoff, do you mean tire wear particles or are you asking about chemicals?
All materials in roadway runoff. We know there's a lot of things on the road besides tire wear, brake wear, other sources. What technologies are available to help to minimize the loading from roadways into receiving waters?
Well, there are, you know, there are a lot of green stormwater infrastructure technologies out there, things like bioretention, rain gardens, bioswales. There's a really long list. I wouldn't even attempt to give a comprehensive list of stormwater treatment technologies and which ones are effective for which chemicals and sources and materials.
Thank you so much, Dr. Peter. So this concludes our Q&A session for Dr. Peter's presentation. We will now take a 10-minute break and resume at 3:25. Okay, thank you for joining us as we return from a short break. I'll now invite Dr. Leah Chepwe from the University of Toronto to share her presentation. Christy, next slide, please.
My name is Leah Chepwe, and I'm a postdoctoral scholar at the University of Toronto with Dr. Chelsea Rockman. I'm excited to be at this workshop, and I thank the organizers for the invitation to participate. Tire microplastics are an emerging environmental concern for several reasons. They are ubiquitous, contain many chemicals and additives, any of these which can be proprietary, vary between brands and types of tires, and can be toxic. Tire particles are a particular concern because of the potential risks to aquatic organisms, as they can enter surface waters through rain and storm events. In this presentation, I will give an overview of some of our work using freshwater fathead minnows to study the chemical composition and toxicological effects of leachates prepared from tire particles. Specifically, I will focus on two studies. First, published by lead author Anna Colomihea, increased temperature and turbulence alter the effects of leachates from tire particles on fathead minnow, and a deep dive into the complex chemical mixture and toxicity of tire well particle leachate in fathead minnow. In the first study, we wanted to understand how chemicals released or leached from tires affect fathead minnows and how these effects vary when the tires are leached under different environmental parameters that represent a changing climate. These were changes in UV light due to ozone depletion, temperature and carbon dioxide changes, and mechanical stress meant to represent increased or severe storm events. For the study, we produced tire particles from two new tires of the Michelin and Bridgestone brands, and these particles were leached in water for 10 days under the different environmental conditions shown before exposure to fathead minnow embryos in 5-day hatch out experiments to assess toxicity effects. Our results showed that both tires were toxic to embryos. We observed several malformations after hatching and a loss in eye and body pigmentation in embryos that were exposed to tires. We analyzed the tire particles for polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, which are known to be present in tires and represent toxic chemicals, and observed compositional differences between the tires, which likely suggests the differences in formulations of tires. In the leachates at the time, we qualitatively determined the presence of zinc and priority PAHs. In terms of climate change impacts, we saw no apparent trends with increasing carbon dioxide or UV light when the embryos were exposed to the leachates. However, with increasing temperature and mechanical stress, we saw that hatching success of the embryos decreased and the number of embryos with severe deformities increased. This suggests that toxicity effects of tire wear will vary, that warmer places could see greater impacts with increasing global temperatures, or that changes to seasonal temperatures could increase the leaching rate of chemicals in tires. Additionally, rainfall and extreme weather events such as hurricanes, tsunamis, earthquakes, and floods, which represent mechanical stress, may also influence the rate at which chemicals leach from tires. We further wanted to understand why the tire particle leachates from the Michelin brand were particularly toxic to the embryos. However, this time we additionally investigated how the toxicity effects of leaching varied if the particles were leached for 1, 3, and 10 days, and in the presence and absence of tire particulates. Leaching was done at 34 degrees Celsius, as these represent some of Ontario's record summer temperatures. We then used non-target analysis, which is a method that essentially aims to see any chemicals present in a sample and identify them based on what is present in library databases. We observed increasing toxicity with increasing days of leaching, with the most severe deformities and lowest hatch rates and head success rates in the day 10 leachates. We identified over 50 chemicals in the tire particle leachates, with 20 chemicals identified by library matching and reference standards, assigning a greater degree of confidence to these. These included benzothiazoles and cyclic amines, many previously detected in tires, and some used as accelerants in the production of rubber. There were many other chemicals identified to a lesser degree of confidence, labeled as unknowns, that were correlated with the day 10 leachates and are likely also contributing to the toxicity effects. We used a statistical method called redundancy analysis to study the relationships between the chemicals we identified with the highest degree of confidence and the toxicity effects we observed in the fish. We observed strong correlations in the day 10 leachates between increased severe deformities and loss of pigment and several chemicals, including benzothiazole, 2-mercaptobenzothiazole, diphenol urea, and diphenol guanidine. These chemicals were also inversely correlated with heart rate, hatching success, hatchability rate, and length. That is, lower heart rate, lower hatching success, lower hatchability, and decreased lengths were associated with higher levels of these chemicals. Our current work continues to examine and further understand the implications of the toxicity effects on fatty minerals from exposure to the tire particle leachates. We're also continuing to characterize the many chemicals we identified as unknowns and understand the role they play in toxicity. Overall, from the two studies I have discussed, we show the increasing temperature and mechanical stress could impact the toxicity effects from tires, highlighting the importance of consideration of multi-stress systems when assessing risk associated with tires. Some chemicals associated with the severe effects we observed are from exposure to tire leachates, such as benzothiazole, have been linked with genotoxic effects and oxidative stress in other organisms. However, there is limited toxicological data for other chemicals comparatively, especially for the cyclic amines. I thank all our collaborators at the University of Toronto and Environment and Climate Change Canada. And I thank you as well for giving me the opportunity to share our work.
All right, thank you, Dr. Chevoy. We'll now take some questions regarding her presentation. So if you have any questions or comments, please click the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen or email Safer Consumer Products at dtsc.ca.gov or press *9 to raise your hand to let us know you have a question by phone. Okay, so first question says, looks like you used hatching success as an endpoint. What other phenotypic endpoints would you look at, and was the lack of pigmentation? I'll go ahead and ask that first part first, and then we'll pick up the second question. So just to repeat
that, I'll tap, but I must like I'll like I do have a starter, so I'll just add type out like my response like in the chat function, and I'll ask Jessica like to read out like my response, like since I.
Okay. That may take us a moment to kind of sort out. So I'll go ahead and insert the questions for Dr. Cheboy. In the meantime, I will have, looks like Julie Panko has a question.
Yes, hi, thank you for the presentation. Actually, I have two questions. The first question is, can you speak to the environmental relevance of the concentrations that you used to create the leachates? And secondly, can you tell us about the temperature that you leached at? You said 34 degrees Fahrenheit, and I'm wondering if that is supposed to represent the temperature of stormwater, or is that the air temperature? Thank you.
I don't see a response yet. Okay. We may have to just read her responses at the end to give her some time to respond to those. Okay. Next question says, can you speak to the environmental relevances of concentrations that you use to create leachates? Can you tell us about the temperature that you use to create the leachate, and what temperature does this represent? So I'm going to go ahead and forward those on over to Dr. Cheboy for her to respond. But she does mention that we looked at the heart rates and the time to hatch. Okay. And so we'll go ahead and just read back her responses at the end. I'm gonna go ahead and move forward with the rest of the presentation in the meantime. And I would like to invite Ms. Cassandra Jonesson from Trent University to present. Before we do that though, if anyone does have a question for Dr. Cheboy, just go ahead and indicate that in your question or comments through the Q&A. Thank you, and Cassandra?
Hi, thank you. So my name is Cassandra Johannesson. I am from Trent University up in Peterborough, Ontario. So today I will be presenting on the tire-derived chemicals, hexamethoxymethylmelamine, diphenylguanidine, and 6-PPD quinone, and how they're transported into urban rivers during rain events. Slide, please. So just to get everybody on the same page, I'm going to do a quick introduction to urban runoff. Slide, please. So we know that runoff from stormwater is a significant source of contamination to urban receiving waters. So researchers in particular have found that runoff from roads is toxic. Recently, we discovered that urban stormwater from roads is acutely lethal to coho salmon. So these chemicals derived from tire wear have been identified as toxic components of runoff from roads, prompting mine and my supervisor's interest in this topic. Slide, please. Okay, so let's get into these tire wear chemicals. Slide, please. And our studies at Trent University have focused on three classes of chemicals derived from tire wear. So firstly, we were interested in this cross-linking agent, hexamethoxymethylmelamine, which I'll abbreviate to HMMM because it's quite a mouthful. And we know that this is used in tire manufacture in addition to its other uses. We were also interested in the vulcanization accelerator 1,3-diphenylguanidine, which was mentioned as well. This will be abbreviated to DPG. And as we know, this is also used in tire manufacture. And finally, we very recently became interested in 6-PPD quinone after the study published in Science. I'll abbreviate this to 6-PPDQ. And as we know, and we'll talk about more tomorrow, this is an oxidation product of 6-PPD, which is frequently used in tire manufacture. And again, 6-PPDQ was recently this year identified as the toxin responsible for that coho salmon mortality in spawning centers. Slide, please. Okay, so we became interested in HMMM when we first detected this compound in passive samplers that were deployed in Great Lakes region, so tributaries of the Great Lakes. Upon further investigation into the literature, we saw that this compound actually readily transforms. So slide, please. Into numerous network of other methoxymethyl compounds. Slide, please. So there's actually 24 structures of these transformation products that have been identified as of now. So although we know their structures, there is quite limited knowledge about these compounds. For example, we do not know their properties, and we do not know, prior to this study and some others, the occurrence of these compounds in our watersheds. Slide, please. So this led us to a rationale for my study, which was part of my master's thesis. Slide, please. So because of this data gap on the occurrence of these tire-derived chemicals, we wanted to quantify HMMM, its transformation products, 6-PPDQ and DPG in urban surface waters in response to rain events. So the idea here was that these compounds or their parent compounds are present in tires and they leach from tires, as other studies have shown us. And when it rains, it will be transported with that runoff into our watersheds. So as a result, we looked at two study areas in the Greater Toronto Area. So this is the most populous metropolitan area in Canada. And we looked at two rivers in specific. Slide, please. So first we looked at Don River. It's denoted by that red circle on the map there, and it's actually just adjacent to a major highway called the Don Valley Parkway. Slide, please. In addition, we looked at Highlands Creek at Morningside Avenue. So this is actually a creek that goes right under a major highway, the Highway 401. Slide, please. So these locations are suspected to get a lot of runoff from these road systems. So samples were collected using flow-weighted ISCO samplers. Slide, please. And these samplers were triggered during major storm events, so typically above 10 millimeters in precipitation. Slide, please. And we were interested to get kind of a comprehensive picture of the occurrence of these compounds. We took two different approaches for sampling. So one of these approaches was to collect temporal samples. And these temporal samples were collected every hour and pulled in 3-hour increments across the storm event, so up to 42 hours after the event. And these samples serves as a little snapshot of what is going on during the event in terms of contamination. Slide, please. In addition, we took composite samples, which were collected over the entire event, so right from when it started raining to after 42 hours, and this served as more of a look at the average contaminant profile during the rain events. Slide, please. And all analysis on the samples was done using liquid chromatography with high-resolution mass spectrometry in-house at Trent University at our Water Quality Center. Slide, please. Okay, so let's get into filling in part this data gap, looking at our data summary. Slide, please. Okay, so here we are showing the average concentration of HMMM detected in both of our watersheds in those composite samples. So this serves to represent the average concentration during those rain events. So what I wanted to point out here is that HMMM was detected in all the samples we took after rain events. And we saw more elevated concentrations in the fall than we did in the winter. So we saw higher concentrations around 1 ppb, so parts per billion, in the fall compared to around 0.4 ppb in the winter. Again, concentrations started to rise in March. And this sample was actually taken in response to a snow melt. So we had lots of our snow in Toronto melt on this day, indicating perhaps this contaminant is sequestered by snow and then released, or just the snow is acting like rain and carrying the contaminant to our watershed. However, I also want to point out that we absorbed our lowest concentration of HMMM in late March of 2020. So this was actually when we went into lockdown for COVID-19. So this indicates that potentially there was less tire wear particles able to leach this compound that would then be transported into our environment. Slide, please. Okay, so I mentioned we also took temporal samples to kind of see the changes of the concentration during the storm event. And what I wanted to point out here for HMMM, firstly, is that there is a delay between the peak concentration that we observed and the peak discharge. So this indicates that it takes some time, some hours between when peak discharge occurs for that peak concentration to occur, which suggests more of a middle flush effect. And this can inform sampling methodologies and also treatment methodologies to know which runoff is important to collect and treat. In addition, the profile, this pollutograph of HMMM closely corresponds to the hydrograph of the site, which is seen on the right here. We see those kind of bimodal peaks, both in the concentration and the hydrograph. Slide, please. In addition, we were, of course, interested in these various transformation compounds of HMMM. So we looked for them as well. And we found out of the 24 structures identified for the transformation products, we detected 17 of them in our samples and were able to quantify 15 of them, indicating that they may be ubiquitous in the urban environment as well, along with HMMM. So a particular note here is this compound that's denoted by D200, which is our nomenclature for dimethoxymethylmelamine. So this is a compound that has two methoxymethyl arms instead of the six, the parent compound, HMMM. So this compound was detected above, in concentrations above that of HMMM, but also very elevated concentrations. So for example, in Highlands Creek, it was detected at 11 parts per billion. So this indicates that definitely further research is oriented into these transformation products, but in particular, this dimethoxymethylmelamine because it's present at those elevated concentrations. Slide, please. Okay, so getting into the data now for DPG and 6-PPDQ, again, we detected them in all our rain event samples, indicating their ubiquitous nature in the urban environment. And in particular, I would like to point out here how 6-PPDQ was detected in our Toronto waters above the LC50 value, so the concentration at which 50% of the species, in this case, coho salmon, are expected to die if they are exposed to this concentration. So it was pretty consistently detected above those levels, indicating that this compound is a stressor to the coho salmon that are actually kind of bred into these lakes, in addition, potentially other aquatic species as well. Slide, please. Okay, and we also wanted to look at those pollutographs for these compounds as well in particular. We are still seeing this time lag between peak concentration and peak discharge, which again can inform sampling as well as treatment. But what is of particular interest here is that on the right, we can see that the rivers were being exposed to concentrations of 6-PPDQ that were consistently above the LC50 value throughout the event, but that very elevated, so above almost close to 3 actually ppb concentrations of 6-PPD quinone were detected for many hours, around 10 hours during that rain event. Okay, slide, please. So in conclusion, we can see that tire wear compounds are transported into those urban rivers during rain and snow melt events. And these concentrations correspond to the hydrograph, but with delay of several hours after the start of the rain event. We also saw that concentrations of 6 ppdq exceeded the toxic threshold for coho salmon found by TNAL. And these concentrations actually persist for several hours during the rain event. In addition, if we were to convert these concentrations to mass loads, we actually found that these mass loads exceed so they are in the range of kilogram amounts that are being exposed in the waterways. I would like to thank our collaborators, NSERC, as well as the Ministry, Ontario Ministry of Environment, Conservation and Parks. And thank you for listening.
Thank you, Ms. Johannesson. So we'll now be taking some questions regarding her presentation. Again, if you have any questions or comments, please click the Q&A button and enter your question or comment, or email us at Safer Consumer Products, or press *9 to raise your hand by phone. So our first question says, have you seen any toxicity of coho salmon in the Great Lakes region?
So I have looked for data on this and I haven't seen any myself, although at these levels, it seems to me like it would be occurring. I haven't been able to get down to the sites during spawning season, but I do expect it's happening, although this data isn't present.
Okay, thank you. Next question says, do you know if there have been any relevant observed aquatic impacts from the rainfall events in the Two Rivers samples?
None of my, so we have not had this data yet. So this research is quite new to the Toronto region on these specific chemicals. I do expect that this research will kind of increase in the coming year, especially with the published report by TNAL. So that will be very interesting to see. So I'm looking forward to that data.
Thank you. Next question says, how did you choose to focus your research specifically on these three chemicals? Were there any chemicals that you considered, or during your sampling, did you find high volumes of other chemicals of concern?
So great question. So HMMM was detected during non-targeted analysis of our passive samplers deployed in the Great Lakes region. So that kind of alerted us to this compound, and then looking at the research already published by, for example, Peter AL, who detected at this time the HMMM in the stormwater, but it was still unknown what was causing that mass coho salmon mortality. So at this point, 6 ppdq was not known. We became very interested in that compound as well as its transformation products. In those passive samplers, we also detected DPG, so diphenylguanidine. And again, looking at the study by Peter, they also detected this compound, which alerted us more. So we wanted to include that as well. So those were my main two compounds that I focused on for my master's thesis. And then kind of when I was getting ready to defend and write my thesis, the study by TNAL came out about 6 ppdq. So I quickly went back to our archive samples to look for it. So that's how we became interested for this compound. But there are numerous other leachates that are of interest or that should be of interest to scientists, such as like those propylene glycols, but they were just not included in this study.
Okay. So it says, were the environmental levels of the chemicals measured only in the dissolved phase, or also the presence of tire-derived particles was taken into account? Fish like salmon would both ingest particulates as well as get into their gills.
Great question. So in this study, we just looked at the dissolved phase. So I guess in that sense, it's kind of a lower estimate of what the species might actually be exposed to, considering those solid phase particulates as well. But in the study, it was water samples that were kind of greatly filtered to get rid of those particulates.
Okay, and then our final question is, they're wondering if you have any data on these chemicals in dry conditions.
Sorry, present in?
Dry conditions.
Oh, in dry conditions. Yes, I actually do. It's not included in this presentation, but I have a paper that was recently published in Environmental Pollution, looking at both wet events and dry events. So to summarize, basically, HMMM and Assured Information Products, as well as DPG and 6-PPDQ, either were not detected or detected at significantly lower concentrations during dry rain events, so low flow periods. That study also looked at sites surrounding a wastewater treatment plant. So we looked upstream at a discharge point and downstream on a dry sampling day to see how they would dilute if the wastewater treatment plant was the source. So if that question is of interest to you as well, I would refer you to the environmental pollution paper.
All righty. Thank you so much. So that concludes our Q&A session for Ms. Johannesson's presentation. And I will now invite Dr. Rebecca Sutton from the San Francisco Estuary Institute to present. Next slide, please.
Thank you. I'm grateful to be part of this really information-rich workshop today. I'm going to be presenting environmental monitoring data from the Regional Monitoring Program for Water Quality in San Francisco Bay. And so I'm going to be showing you that a lot of these tire ingredients we've been talking about today are present in San Francisco Bay. Next slide, please, 129. So the Regional Monitoring Program, or the RMP, has developed a recent focus on tire drive contaminants, and that's as the result of two independent studies. The first one is a non-targeted analysis, and we heard about that technique a little bit earlier today. It's a relatively recently developed technique, and it's great for taking a really broad look at samples and trying to identify as many different contaminants as possible within those samples. So it's a great method for, in particular, looking for things you might not have expected in your samples. And so when we applied non-targeted analysis to a stormwater influence site within San Francisco Bay, the site's called San Leandro Bay, we ended up identifying some of these same tire drive contaminants in that site, in the sample water. So bay water had some of these chemicals. And so that really opened our eyes to tires as a source of chemical contaminants to the bay. Now, at the same time, we also ran this major microplastics effort that you've heard mentioned a few different times today. For this microplastic study, it was a 3-year study, and we did examine microplastics in bay water, bay sediment, bay biota, as well as wastewater and stormwater being discharged to the bay. And in this study, we did identify some unusually high levels of microplastics in stormwater. Stormwater really hadn't been thoroughly investigated at this time for microplastics. So this was some pretty new findings. And almost half the particles we saw in stormwater were these black rubbery particles that we've now been able to tie to tires. And in particular, that's the Werbowski et al. Citation there. Can provide more information on the pyrolysis GCMS that allowed us to tie these particles to tires. So as a result of these two studies, the RMP is taking a hard look at some of these tire drive contaminants, and I'm going to present a number of different findings throughout the years that we've developed on these contaminants. Oh, next slide, please. All right, so we've been referring to the DTSC summary document, and here I've got the different chemicals or chemical classes provided in this summary document. And this is basically a little table of contents for my talk. I'm going to talk about each one of these in the bay. And basically the overall message, you know, beyond all the quantities that you're going to see, the concentrations, is that all of these chemicals are present in our environment. They are all present in San Francisco Bay. Next slide, please. All right, so first, benzothiazoles. We've heard a bit about these. We have unpublished data from Dr. Da Chen at Jinan University. He was our analytical partner. And he analyzed 22 water samples that we collected in 2017 from all throughout San Francisco Bay, 22 different sites. And what I'm providing here in this table are numbers, ranges of concentration, and the median concentration of these couple benzothiazoles that we have observed in San Francisco Bay. So we know these are present in bay water. Next slide, please. All right, so where are they coming from? Well, luckily, we've also got some information on Bay Area stormwater, and this is through a collaboration with Ed Coloche, who will be one of our speakers tomorrow on 6BPD quinone. So he has provided a series of analytical results for some different benzothiazoles in stormwater. And what I'm showing you with this table are the range of concentrations we are observing at stormwater sample collection sites with major roadways influence versus the reference site. So most of our sites with major roadways influence are downstream of pretty urban watersheds. There is one example, though, one particular site where actually most of the watershed is open space, but then Highway 4 passes right by the sample collection point. So we still have a pretty heavy roadways and traffic influence at that site, despite much of the rest of the watershed being open space. Now, you can generally see for these benzothiazoles, the sites with roadways tend to have much higher concentrations compared to that reference site, which is more fully open space without major roadways influence. And these are from 9 different stormwater sites samples we collected over the wet season from 2018 to 2019. Next slide, please. All right, chlorinated paraffins. So we heard from the tire industry earlier today that these are not being used in U.S. tires. That's important information. And what I would like to know is whether that's also true of tires from other manufacturers. Because of course, the U.S. Tire Manufacturers Association can represent U.S. tires. But I'm very curious, what about all the imports that we are driving on here in California? In terms of environmental monitoring data, I can let you know that our Bay biota do have short-chain chlorinated paraffins in their tissues. And in particular, we see notable levels in steel blubber. Now, these chemicals are probably hanging out with the blubber because they are lipophilic. They like the fat. Now, what we don't have are medium and long-chain chlorinated paraffin concentrations. And that's a little bit of a trouble spot because actually in the U.S., we've phased out production of short-chain chlorinated paraffins, but there is some concern that for some uses or some industries, they might be switching from short chains to medium or long chains. And would that be considered a regrettable substitution? Well, that's yet to be determined. So this is a data gap in terms of San Francisco Bay. Next slide, please. All right, diphenylguanidine and hexamethoxymethylmelamine. So we've been talking about these quite a bit in earlier presentations. These were two of the chemicals that we spotted in our San Francisco Bay stormwater influence site, that little San Leandro Bay site that we studied using non-target analysis. So these are the two compounds that really drew our attention to tires as a source of contaminants. So we know they're present in San Francisco Bay. We do not yet have quantitative data. We don't have the concentration in San Francisco Bay. But we do have that concentration in stormwater, thanks to our work with Ed Coloche. So once again, in this table, I'm indicating that sites with roadways, that roadways influence, the traffic influence, have much higher concentrations of these compounds relative to our reference site, which has minimal roadways influence. Next slide, please. Octylphenol ethoxylates in stormwater. Okay, so here I'm presenting some unpublished data. It's now being prepared in a manuscript at this time. And this is coming from a pretty wide-ranging study led by Lee Ferguson at Duke University. And what I'm showing with this table here are, at the bottom are a number of different sites, stormwater sites, where we've collected samples. And the different colors you're seeing in this table are different types of ethoxylated surfactants. Now, this includes both alcohol ethoxylates and alkylphenol ethoxylates. When we're talking about octylphenol ethoxylates, look at the purple clusters on the far right of each of these little clusters of colors. So you are seeing that these purple clusters of octophenolic oxalates are widely detected in a number of our stormwater sites, and in particular, some of our higher detections, such as at the outfall at Gilman Street, those have major highways influencing that watershed. So we are seeing a roadways influence. Certainly, it would be interesting to know whether that is coming from tires or whether it might be from other kind of vehicles or other kinds of sources. Next slide, please. All right, PAHs and alkyl PAHs. So these polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, we have been discussing these, and within the RMP, we also study alkyl PAHs, and we have routine or regular monitoring of these in a number of different bay matrices, including water, sediment, stormwater, and bivalves. And the graph you're seeing right here is actually some bivalve data that you can see goes back a number of years. Now, PAHs have a number of sources. It's not just tires. And in fact, some of what motivates our routine monitoring is so that we can see signals from the occasional oil spill that might occur within San Francisco Bay. Nevertheless, that background signal, when it's not an oil spill, could have some tires contribution. And so we do see tires generally present in all our bay matrices. And here, these are bivalve levels that you're seeing. Again, mussels that we've deployed within the bay for 3 months, and then we pull out and harvest the tissues and analyze them. And we are seeing pretty consistent levels of both PAHs and alkyl PAHs in our bay bivalve. Next slide, please. So I want to note, even beyond what we've looked at so far today, that there are some studies out there of tire tread or crumb rubber that have identified other contaminant classes of potential interest. So I've reviewed some recent literature and seen mention of detections of bisphenols, glycols and glycol ethers, and phthalates in either crumb rubber or leachate. And so I'm curious whether these might be ingredients in tires or perhaps impurities, and whether they might, whether tires could be a source, one of many, for environments like San Francisco Bay. I know for sure that these three classes are all present in bay water and or bay sediment. And then stepping even further back, that we've been talking already about a number of other vehicle sources. So it's not just tires, but our vehicles can have other impacts on water quality, perhaps due to the paints, as we've been discussing, the fluids. There could be other sources of contaminants, and that could explain some of these detections in roadway runoff as well. So I've listed a couple of common detections in roadway runoff, including amine-based chemicals and organophosphate esters. All right, next slide. So my take-home messages are that stormwater does carry tire particles and associated chemicals into San Francisco Bay. And the chemical ingredients in tires are present in bay water, sediment, and biota. Well, that's my talk, so I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Dr. Sutton. Next, okay. So we'll now be taking questions on Dr. Sutton's presentation. Again, if you have any questions or comments, please click the Q&A or press *9 by phone, and you can also email Safe for Consumer Products. So first question that we have says, were there any trends in terms of where the sites were with the highest detections of the different compounds?
That's an interesting question. At this time, this is an ongoing study. Actually, our fourth and final year of monitoring for stormwater will be this coming wet season, and let's hope we get a good one. So at this time, we've only investigated the difference between the reference site and the other sites. We haven't thoroughly looked at the other sort of land use trends that might be possible to winnow out from looking hard at the data. So to be continued, we should have some more information soon.
Great. Okay, next question says, do you have any information about the biodiversity index at the different sampling locations?
Ooh, I do not have that information, but I do have colleagues at the Institute who do CRAM assessments and other similar wildlife assessments, so maybe I can get that.
Okay. Next question says, have you tested for these tire-related compounds under dry weather conditions as well?
Oh, great question. Not yet. No, we have been fairly focused on wet weather, and that is primarily because a lot of our conceptual models for these contaminants and others suggest that the major loads to the bay occur during wet weather conditions. And of course, as the regional monitoring program for the bay, we tend to be focused on the bay in terms of an ecosystem rather than the tributaries themselves. That is a very important question.
Okay. It looks like we have some questions from that says, what do you have regarding sources of HMMM? What data, excuse me?
Well, I've learned quite a bit today. We have not looked at true source identification for HMMM. We have focused primarily on environmental monitoring. So after the source, when it's in the ecosystem itself. So we don't have information at this time and have not done studies on different types of sources.
Okay. And then our last question says, are there observed coho mortality with those concentrations of 6 PPD?
Well, in San Francisco Bay, we no longer have coho salmon. So they used to be in our tributaries, but they are no longer. Now, one thing to note is that there are some concerns that these could, 6 PPD quinone, and maybe perhaps some of these other chemicals could be having effects on other less sensitive salmon, such as steelhead. Those are present in San Francisco Bay tributaries. So I know there are some ongoing studies elsewhere to look at the toxicity and sublethal effects of many of these urban stormwater compounds to see what else we might be missing when we think about the health of our fish.
All right, thank you, Dr. Sutton. So that concludes our Q&A for your presentation. We're going to move on to the public comment period. Comments, so Christy, next slide, please. I'm gonna read through any public comments. I'll give you guys a chance to input any public comment you have, and then we will move on to any questions that you might have. So right now it's just for the public comment. And then if you have any questions, we'll hold those for a minute. I will also read Dr. Chibwe's responses in the Q&A portion. So I'll give you a couple moments for any public comments. Okay, so what I would like to do now, since there doesn't appear to be any public comments, is move on to our Q&A session. So I'm going to go back and read some of the questions that we have for Dr. Chibwe and her responses on those. So the first question, her response was... So this is a response to the verbal question. It says, our primary focus was to get an idea of what was leaching from the tires and the driving the effects and to build the suspect list. With this suspect list and these chemicals, we are currently working towards an environmentally relevant approach, including using range of various new and used tires, as well as exposures under the environmentally relevant temps. The 34 Celsius temp that was used was meant to represent a worst case climate change scenario. Higher road temps following the results of our first climate change impact driven study. Okay, and then we have another response that says, these were embryonic exposures experiments, so they ended when the eggs hatched. Other endpoints we looked at were time hatched, heart rates, and lengths, as we characterize the degree of malformations at hatch. The lack in pigmentation was observed at hatch, and we are still investigating whether pigment loss is sustained beyond the hatching and what implications this might have for fish. Okay, and then the last question that we have for her, her response says, the concentrations were definitely higher than the environmental concentrations. Our primary focus was to get an idea of what was, that might be the same one. as the road temp. So yeah, so this essentially answers the same question as the last one, that they were looking at worst case climate change scenarios and that they're working towards a more environmentally relevant approach. Okay. And then I'm going to move on to some of the other questions. It says, okay, so at this time, we would like to pose a discussion question to be answered by speakers and audience members. We would like suggestions on other chemicals related to research and a quick rationale behind their suggestion. Okay. I'm going to go ahead and also pose that another discussion question to be answered by any speakers or audience members. What are the next steps needed to clarify the source of the chemicals in the environment? Would anyone like to respond to that? Okay, Kelly Grant.
Hi, Jessica. I was wondering if maybe the panelists would turn on their cameras and we could maybe stop sharing the slides so that we could have a discussion more.
We do have one more Q&A before we do that. I'm going to read that last one and then we'll move towards the actual discussion portion of it. And I'll go ahead and reread the discussion questions. But the last question that we have here, it says, given the number of chemicals and complexity of the questions remaining, what consideration is being given to green stormwater runoff technologies?
I think that's an important question to ask. I know even some of the work that the SFEI has done found that green stormwater infrastructure bioretention is successful in reducing microplastics loading from stormwater into receiving water. And I do know the University of Washington has also done additional research showing that running stormwater through bioretention technologies mitigates any impacts on coho salmon as well. So I think that's an important question to ask.
I think it's also challenging to know how we could implement stormwater treatment for all of the stormwater. So I think source control is always going to be an important component as well. Just thinking about the volumes of stormwater and the available space and money for that type of treatment.
It may be applicable in areas of hotspots.
This is Andre Alghazi from DTSC. I just chime in that under our framework, we're sort of in the problem identification phase here as far as our preliminary screening research. So some of the information that we're going to receive from you all during the during today's event, as well as through the public comment period, will help us decide, you know, what to pursue as potential priority products, if anything, from among the chemicals we've talked about today. And I think those types of solutions could come into play maybe in making decisions, but also if we were to list something as a priority product, it could be a potential regulatory response option when we got to that point. That's hypothetical, that's out into the future, but I'd say it's early days for to talk about our consideration we're giving to green stormwater runoff technologies at this point. It's really not where we are in the process at this time.
Okay. If no one else wants to respond to that, I'll just remind that the discussion questions are if there's any suggestions on other chemicals and the rationale, as well as what steps are needed to clarify the source of those chemicals. Go ahead, Ed.
Yeah, just since other chemicals came up, you know, I remain curious to know the tire industry's position on some of the phenolic antioxidants, like the BHD antioxidants. Those are some compounds that we detected that, again, we're not sure where they're coming from, but they do seem to be associated or present in tire leachate. And I wondered if those were used in tire manufacturing. Similarly, I think there's a bunch of these organophosphate compounds, you know, that again, that a lot of them have multiple uses, multiple sources, but I think Becky might have mentioned them as well. And I think those are important to think about as potentially also present in some of these tire products. So those are two things I might raise as possibilities.
Ed, we're always happy to chat with you more. You know that. Happy to provide more information too. I do want to point out, you know, we want to make sure we're putting safe tires on the road. When you get in your car every day and you drive your family from point A to point B, we want to make sure that product stays together and performs safely. So while tires contain a number of substances, I think we all want to make sure tires continue to perform safely on our roadways.
I have two kids in my car. I absolutely want safe tires just as much as you. I guarantee it.
Go ahead, Kelly.
I was hoping you all could maybe comment on where you see the greatest data gaps in the research and where you'd like your research to proceed to fill those data gaps.
I can say from our perspective with the tire industry, I think it's important if we're looking at certain substances in stormwater that we also identify what could be all the possible contributors to that particular substance. We pointed out in particular for HMM, when we had conversations with HMM manufacturers, that the largest source of that material is in clear coating on vehicles, which they said can degrade quite quickly. So I think it's important to look at all sources of particular materials as part of the research.
For me, I'm most interested in HMM and its transformation products right now. And I think a big area we need to focus on is generating commercial standards for the various transformation products. Of course, this can also apply to the various transformation products of 6-PPD, because we do know that there is a range of them in addition to 6-PPD quinone, as well as diphenylguanidine. Some of its transformation products are known to be toxic, including the chlorinated and brominated transformation products. So the generation of commercial standards allows for more robust analysis, as well as property determination. And in that way, we can get an accurate assessment of their environmental fate, as well as comprehensive toxicity testing.
Dr. Booth, did you have a comment?
Yeah. I would like to see a little bit more work on the persistence side as well with a lot of these chemicals, because I think it's an issue we haven't really touched upon so much today. It's been focused on mapping concentration, distribution, occurrence, and then assessing toxicity of these chemicals and metabolites, degradation products, intermediates. But it's not something I've looked into a lot, so there may be work on this, but I think it's a key part of any sort of assessment on risk of each of these chemicals. And just to reiterate that I think it's also really, really important that we have broader focus on sources. You know, we've seen this in the past, and we've seen it a lot with plastic-related research, that, you know, you pick up on certain chemicals or certain aspects of plastic, and you know, we've banned cotton buds or Q-tips, you call them in the US, you know, I mean, that's really going to save the world. You know, when you look at what's actually littering beaches, it's not Q-tips, you know. So I think it's really important to look at where else these chemicals might be coming from, and that we're not just sort of picking on one particular industry.
Okay, Ed. Oh, you're muted.
Sorry about that. Just following Andy's comment there. I know every industry is really sensitive to, you know, the source question, and everybody on this call wants a really good mass balance for some of these chemicals that are popping up in the environment. And I would just point out that every industry has the opportunity to release chemical ingredient, chemical masses, chemical concentrations, which I think would facilitate an accurate mass balance on everyone's part. You know, I know there's a bunch of simplistic tire rubber formulas out there, but I have to think when I go to the store and pay a bunch of money for an expensive tire, that some of that comes down to some interesting chemicals to provide more safety, more longevity, more, you know, stick properties, whatever, more gas mileage, right? All these things are related. And so I would point out that's a clear opportunity to help that source apportionment mass balance aspect. I would also like to maybe mention one data gap. I think there's been some conversation today around tire and road wear particles, which I absolutely agree are a mobile phase of interest here. I would urge us not to forget about the fact that every road has immobile rubber on it, you know, those skid mark type things, and the tires themselves. I think Howard Colvin showed us a picture of a car driving through a puddle today and on a rainy street. The tires themselves are part of this system that we can't ignore with respect to just the tire and road wear particles. So I'm pretty darn sure that leachable organic contaminants are washing off our tires on our cars as they roll down the road. And I just encourage us to really think of that as part of our system as well.
I just have a quick comment on that, something that Ed raised. I'm interested if the tire experts have any expertise on the different formulations between summer and winter tires. With my data, I did see some seasonal variation, so I'm interested to know if maybe the composition of those summer versus winter tires can help explain that. I know in Toronto, we get, you know, brutal winters and everybody's changing their tires into those winter tires. So I believe that that kind of data gap is important if we can work towards publishing those compositions for different brands, but as well as that summer versus winter tires. I think that would be very helpful for researchers.
Thank you. Dr. Sutton?
This is kind of along those same lines. Is I'm definitely very curious about tire manufacturers outside the USTMA group, because USTMA has provided a lot of great information today, and I'm just wondering how broadly we can generalize those statements about chemical composition when there's so many imported tires that may be, you know, from manufacturers that USTMA does not actually represent at this time. And then speaking also to the particulate question, it's a very, these tire and roadway particles are really interesting, and they come in a range of sizes that are not really super well characterized at this point. And with the extra small particles, you can get that air transport, which can take them much farther distances than these roadways. Again, beyond size, we've got the surface area issue that Dr. Moran brought up this morning. So I feel like even another data gap is just far better and more comprehensive characterization of all the different sizes of tire and roadway particle and their surface areas, because that could influence the type and amount of leaching that's occurring for all these chemicals that we're so interested in.
Thank you, Dr. Sutton. Sarah?
I think there has actually been quite a good bit of research done by the World Business Council for Sustainable Development Tire Industry Project to work to characterize the size distribution of how tire and road wear particles exist in the environment. I don't know if Julie's still on, but she could probably speak to some of that work.
Yes, I'm still on. Can you not see me, Sarah?
I can't, but now I can.
Okay. Yes. So I think quite a bit of work has been done to characterize the size distribution of tire and road wear particles. Back in 2010, the first paper was published on these particles and gave a really comprehensive overview of size distribution, both by volume and by particle count. Also gave a description of the morphology, as well as some chemical composition information. More recently, a paper came out by Kovacic et al., who presented a method for identifying single particles of single tire and road wear particles in environmental matrices. And so some additional characterization data was provided there as well. And as Dr. Sutton said, you know, the particles have a pretty broad range. The vast majority of them that are generated are over probably 200 to 300 microns in size by mass, the majority. But the ones that are on the road are probably somewhere around 50 to 80 microns as a sort of a median size distribution. And then a smaller percentage has been, you know, demonstrated to be airborne. Quite a few studies, both done by the TIP as well as other researchers, are characterizing, you know, the contribution of TRWP to PM2.5 and PM10. So I think there is a good deal of work going on the non-exhaust emission air side, which tire wear particles are a part of.
Yeah, we've definitely seen quite a few studies, but they do tend to be a bit siloed. Like the air folks use the air methods and have their size fraction cutoffs, and then the water folks use different methods. So it can be a little hard to harmonize across these broad size categories.
Yeah, I think that also brings up a good point in terms of quantifying the particles. You know, people are using a variety of different methods to do so. And, you know, the TIP developed a really robust method for the mass quantification in terms of, you know, the like micrograms per gram quantification of TRWP in environmental matrices like soil and sediment, as well as air. And it's a pyrolysis GC mass spec method that is really very specific to the tire tread. Lots of researchers are looking at different types of pyrolysis methods to make those quantifications. And, you know, we really think that there should be one method. I think the single particle analysis method is not as sophisticated in terms of the number of times it's been used. It would be good to align on that kind of methodology as well.
Okay, thank you. Dr. Peter?
Yeah, so I guess I have two separate data gaps. First, just building off of what Julie was just saying with, you know, needing methods for understanding what masses of tire particles are in a water or sediment sample. I think it also is really challenging to, as we think about the chemicals that are leaching out of tire particles, to understand what equivalent mass of tire particles that relates to. And so we need methods that can help us have an understanding of what that profile of chemicals leaching out of tire particles and how persistent they are, like Dr. Booth mentioned, to be able to translate that back to how big these reservoirs of tire particles potentially are that are contributing to that profile that's being observed in surface waters and in runoff. And then also building off of things that were mentioned earlier with respect to transformation products, I'm really curious about whether some of these transformations products that we're observing, for example, the MMM family, or even, you know, other chemicals like phenylguanidine is a diphenylguanidine transformation product that we see a lot, whether that's being produced during the manufacturing process and whether the tire manufacturers actually have some knowledge potentially that they could share about how much of those transformation products are already present in the rubber before it hits the road, so to speak, versus is being produced after the fact in the environment.
Okay, it looks like we have a question from one of our attendees. There's a phone caller with the last three digits of 805. If you can press *6 to unmute yourself and voice your question.
Hi, this is Kelly Moran. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can. Oh, no. Go ahead and unmute yourself again, if you can. *6. Oh, there you go.
Okay. Hi, this is Kelly Moran. I was a speaker in the morning session, and I just want to follow up a little bit on the discussion about the particle characterization. Dr. Sutton correctly mentioned, there's kind of a bifurcation between the air world and the water world on the characterization of the particles. So there's a particle size distributions from one world and the other world, but not a combination thereof. Although I think the data are sufficient to suggest that most of the mass is in the larger particles, not as large as someone suggested they were over 100 microns. And I don't think that the mass data support that characterization. I think it's the median particle size was somewhere around 50 or so. There's a couple of different papers with that information. But more importantly, the specific surface area has not been reported in the literature. And there can be different amounts of specific surface area on the different particles. So there's not one specific surface area for all the tire particles. The smaller the particle, the more surface area per amount of mass of particle. But as you saw in those who saw my presentation this morning, saw that the particles are extremely irregular. So even the larger particles may have quite a lot of surface area. It's not uncommon for that in friction particles to be, say, 100 times the surface area of a standard powder that one might purchase. So that surface area matters a lot because it's the surface of the particle where the chemicals are released into the environment. The data discussed this afternoon and elsewhere are pretty compelling that chemicals are released surprisingly quickly from the particles into water, for example, during storm events. That suggests that there's a lot of surface area somewhere. And better understanding that would help identify which kind of characterization experimental data are valid and important to use for interpretation of the literature, because there's a lot of conflicting literature in this area that I personally think, based on evaluation of that relationship between specific surface area and chemical release, that part of that conflict has to do with the characteristics and surface areas of the particles that were under testing. So my apologies for going on for so long, but I just wanted to make sure that it was clear to folks that this surface area is actually integral to understanding the chemical release and which particles matter the most and therefore control options other than reformulation. Thank you.
Okay, I'll invite any final comments or questions. Okay, so it looks like this concludes our Q&A session as well as our presentation for today. Thank you for your interest in participating, especially during this unprecedented time. I will now pass it off to Andre for closing comments.
Thank you, Jessica. And I want to thank all of our speakers for sharing their data and diverse perspectives on chemicals and tires this afternoon. And I want to acknowledge that some of you are working late to be here, and specifically Dr. Booth, where it's after 1:30 in the morning. So thank you so much. It's been an information-filled day. And you've given us a lot to think about as we consider whether to pursue additional research on the chemicals discussed today and potentially identify new priority products. I also want to acknowledge our excellent staff for their screening research, for developing the summary posted on our CalSafer portal, and for their work organizing today's workshop. As we mentioned earlier, our comment period will be open until Friday, September 17th. So you have some time to compile and submit your comments. Our summary document includes a list of questions for each of the chemicals we've looked at that we hope you'll take a look at and help answer. There are a lot more questions there than the ones we, you know, that we had some summary questions today. And as I said at the close of our workshop, public engagement and comments are a key part of our process. If we decide to pursue regulation or one or more of the tire-related chemicals we've talked about today, or maybe other chemicals that you bring to our attention, we'll have additional public events to discuss our findings and ask you for your data, perspectives, and input. So thanks again for attending and participating in our workshop on chemicals in tires, and we hope to see a lot of you at tomorrow's workshop on 6 PPD. So I wish you a pleasant evening, and we look forward to seeing you at 9 o'clock tomorrow Pacific time to talk about 6 PPD. Thank you.